tiny little shorts, balls peeking. Butler brought his lunch, it's some stink shit. Dan's anxiety hasn't peaked yet. Got Sam yelling at me about some weak shit. I'ma show you how I'm living. BDM party canceled. It's fine. Cruise rescheduled. It's fine. Hey, basically I'm saying either way, it's fine. Hey, it's fine. Hey, come on and advertise with me. No, I can get your business action. I can get your product traction. Stand up when I wipe. Yes, it's dumb. Come on, baby, advertise with me. No, stretch your dollar to the max, son. Wish that Dan could relax, son. And you know I podcast every day with him. Thank you if you listen. BDM party canceled. It's fine. Cruise rescheduled. It's fine. Basically, I'm saying either way, it's fine. Hey, please let me die. Hey, they can't all be fine.
Hello, this is your Mediocre Time with Tom and Dan program. We hope that you will find our presentation precise, joke heavy, and just right. Thanks.
Show number 567.
That's wrong.
Yeah, that's wrong. I just realized that. I slid the wrong one in at the last second, rather. Welcome to A Mediocre Time with Tom and Dan. I'm Dan.
I'm Tom.
It's 568 is the correct number, but welcome to the show. Our producer, Samantha, is here. Hello, Sam.
Hey, hey. I'm taking over Bus Decker's.
That's totally fine. What happened to Hey All You Cool Cats and Kittens?
I'm over it.
It burned hot, right?
Yeah.
It burned hot. Is it, well, I mean, I got you a birthday gift. Should be coming here today.
Is it a tiger?
I mean, it's related to that, yeah.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, it is related to that. If it shows up, then I'll let everybody know what it is. But
that's exciting.
Yeah, it's pretty good. Butler is here, our sales guy extraordinaire. Hey there, Butler.
Hey.
ready to fuck your toast up, buddy?
Hey.
Hey.
Oh, yeah. It's me, Butler. Hey.
Right now, we would be getting off a cruise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, yeah. It'd be that morning. You wake up, you feel like shit.
I don't like those. Yeah. I never go hard that. Well, I used to back in the day. I'd go hard the last day. Yeah. I don't go hard the last day anymore or the last night. Like a lot of people do that. They're like, I'm going to stay up all night, bro. You know, this is my last thing I got to fucking do, man.
Yeah.
I'm like, all right. Well, I'm going to go
pack.
I'm going to go watch my wife pack. She won't let me fucking pack. I'm sure she would like for me to, but I'll fuck it all up. I'm a trash bag on the last day guy. When I was single, it'd be suitcase going, last day, everything trash bag. Try to get it in the suitcase, the trash bag of dirty clothes. If it won't fit, you just roll the trash bag on top of the suitcase.
That's smart.
Also, yeah. I can understand staying up all night if you're single and you're looking to bang someone out the last night or so. You know what I'm saying?
I don't think I've ever heard you use the phrase bang someone out, and I'm shamed right now.
When you got to get in the guts.
Yeah. You ought to fucking get some wet slit.
But when you're...
I'm looking for some wet slit, everybody.
When you're...
I hope this cruise has got some wet slit on it because I'm sniffing for it. Need some quality coos, as Tom said last week.
When you're married, though, it's all you can think about is like, is this worth it? I'm just gonna feel like garbage for the next. Like, yeah, what am I doing this for?
Yeah.
And this is only.
But then you do it every day, and then you're like, I can't not do it now. I am a garbage person. I have to be like this for the rest of my life, which will be short because I'm abusing myself horribly.
Yeah. I'm just talking about the old. Get annihilated all night long. Oh, to God. Not worth it.
There have been so many times on cruise ships where I've been standing in a bathroom swing from being inebriated.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like just like fall down drunk.
Mm-hmm. That's what you do on a cruise.
Yeah, it's well. Anyway, let's plug some stuff and get because. Do you have anything to plug?
Well, normally talking about the cruise. If you go to TomandDanCruise.com,
yeah, you can get the latest.
We told everybody about the.
Everybody thinks you have Jersey Shore afro hair now. You do have a Pauly D going.
I combed it.
Pauly D.
It's
but on the camera, it looks like it's molded like the NSYNC No Strings Attached video where they had the plastic hair. Yeah. You look like you got a Pauly D here.
I look at
Captain!
I look at myself in the mirror and I was like, I'm gonna comb my hair, which I normally don't do. Yeah, it's usually disheveled.
No, you comb your hair. Well, you've been combing your hair for like the last 3 years.
Not here, though.
Oh, Grandma Lee died, by the way.
Yeah, she did. R.I.P.
Yeah, really?
Yeah, yeah. Used to have the Grandma Lee haircut.
Yeah. The stooge.
And that always was a joke. Yeah, it was really sad. And Ken Miller was a good friend of hers. And from what I understand, she was a very, very, very sweet woman. We never had her in, which makes me sad because I would have been looking forward to that. But anyway, talking about the cruise.
Yeah, we postponed it for a year. The new date's April 12th. So you can, all the people that were already scheduled to go got the email and all the information. If you didn't, let us know or check your spam because we sent it to everybody.
Oddly enough, Ryan Cabrera Cruise still on.
No.
Which is odd.
It's very, it's very safe odd. Because there's no one on it.
Yeah.
Damn it.
Yeah. It's just him and the ghost of Nick Swardson.
Crazy magician, man.
Oh, yeah.
So,
did you just wink at me?
I blinked.
You inadvertently winked at me. Don't ever do that again. I'll have to HR talk with you later.
That's it. No.
The amount of sexual harassment that Samantha piles on top of me has been...
It is, yeah.
Recently, it's been...
I've been making notes.
Well, because of the whole COVID, I think she's, you know...
Oh.
She came in yesterday, she's like, I'm looking for some wet slick! I'm like, I can't help you.
Yeah. And that's what she calls men's peels.
Yeah, their peels is the wet slick.
I don't know why you want that.
I'm like, how dare you? And then she made me jack off into a plant in front of her.
Yeah. I saw it. I was watching through the
I thought that was jam quarter. I could tell. There's a little raccoon, like a bank robber mask.
I hear a hide in a closet while some dude bangs your wife and you're recording it.
Yeah.
But you're like, oh, he don't see me.
Weird. Well, he knows he you're knows in that. There. Yeah. He put you in there.
Yeah. Why are you?
He's the one that shut the door and made sure that the Panasonic camera lens fit through the door hole.
You know what? We need to interview someone. Because it seemingly...
You can't use that term anymore either.
What?
Cuckold.
Why?
It's racist.
Huh?
Yeah, I looked it up. If you look it up, yeah, you can't use it.
I thought the definition is... I don't even know, but I know it has something to do with you banging some guy's wife and the husband watching.
No, but it has racial... The racial ramifications of it are that it's like it's the bigger black guy banging your wife.
It could be any. It could be anybody, right?
I looked it up on Wikipedia. It said it was racist, and I was like, "Well, can't say that anymore. It's canceled."
The
I thought it was just dude sitting in the corner walking.
Yeah.
I know.
You thought it was like a Dr. Bob scenario. I don't believe so.
Well, sometimes they're. I mean, it seems like the predominant. Guy you get is a black dude in a lot of scenarios, but I've seen it where just a random dude and
then this is a classic case of new racist have taken a term that wasn't racist and then adopted it for what they needed it to say, so now you can't say it without people that don't know you questioning whether or not you're racist. Because white nationalists use it.
Oh, God.
Well, for what? Like,
it says it in the article. My wife. I don't even want to find it, you know, like, but it's almost like you're a race traitor, is what I read.
Really?
Yeah.
That is weird.
It is weird.
I've only known it as
why angry white men love calling people cucks. Is that what
cucks.
You read?
Yeah, cucks.
So are they even?
No, there's that's not the exact article, but there are a lot of articles.
It's like
about
the symbol.
I agree with the vast majority of people say, well, I'm not going to let some racist piece of shit steal something that's not racist and make it their own, and now I can't say it. Yeah. And I agree with
love cockles, and I'm damn sure if those goddamn skinheads take it from me.
If I went to hide. In a closet and have some big black guy bang my wife while I'm videotaping
I pay him the fair rate.
He's my friend.
Yeah.
Some of my best friends are black guys that bang my wife while I videotape them in a closet.
Is he your friend? Like, how? Like, do you watch football with him?
Do you eat ribs with this dude?
Yeah.
Steve, you want to come over and watch the Joe Burrow's Bengals? No Bengals.
I think Tom's a cuckservative.
What's a cuckservative?
A cuck plus a conservative.
Oh, you are a cuckservative.
No, I am not.
You're a cuckservative.
Anyway, the
so
documentary
you wanna
is
be
out.
Okay, you want to be cuckolded? Is that
no? I don't know.
Yeah, our documentary is out now. We thought of this idea. Tell me what you guys in the Twitch chat
it's
room
out for free.
Everybody watching live right now, tell me what you think about this idea because I'm just flying this, just throwing it out there, and I think this would be fun. What if we picked a date one night and we got in here? I mean, just us, because obviously we're still social distancing and doing all the shit we're supposed to do, right? Because we're smart human beings. But in the confines of your own home, since the documentary is on Amazon Plus, we could watch it here and host a party to watch it. If you have it, you can watch it at the same time we're watching it, and we'll do it like Mystery Science Theater style.
And we'll tell and you behind the scenes.
Oh, I will make fun of how fat I look on that scooter. Oh, my God.
Well,
and that's when my scooter would only go 25 miles an hour. I was so fat.
And then
Lee and his Hulk Hogan bandana.
We were just trying to figure out.
I might have him cut out of the new version of the documentary. Or maybe I can CGI you in there.
You get
Butler's not in there at all, is he?
Uh-uh.
No.
We'll get credit.
We had him cut out originally.
You got cucked by Lee.
He didn't understand how. For a while there, Butler was touch and go, and Tom had him cut out. All the scenes that, you cut out the fight that you and Butler got in.
Well, I wasn't about allowed to wear my pants the first.
You got cut out about the fight you guys got into about the grilled cheese.
He
put butter on yours and you were so mad about it and you just wanted it dry because you were a health kick.
Yeah. I remember holding him down and burning his feet. That may have been
with one of those long, big gas grill lighters.
Weird. You know, that's going to come back.
Yeah, but if you guys want to do that, people are saying they would watch that. Yeah, we're going to work on that for you guys. So just, we'll put the date out there. We'll have Tony contact you guys or get it out there in the old social medias to let you know when we can get together and do that.
Speaking of Butler, he told me right before the show, he's like, hey, I got I got the line on this investment. And I'm like, I am all
Butler. Okay, Butler, can I go through some of the things that Butler said this morning? Like,
He tells us all types of shit.
Yeah, all crazy shit. He was like, my mask is too small. It's like a child's mask. And then it fell off.
And then he said he was sucking in dog hair.
Yeah, then he said he was sucking in dog hair and he was mad. Then he said, sometimes my wife treats me like a roommate. And then he cried and went to the bathroom. Then he said, he has a light on the investment. Then he said he
said the dispensary man told him to get some, to not do sativa because he might hit his wife.
Yeah. the dispensary man told you, hey, you look like you slap your wife around. You might want to stay away from the sativa. You are, every time Butler comes in, it's something crazier and crazier and crazier.
So, right before the show, he's like, Juan told me about this investment and it's already, I think it was like 10 times the profit.
I'm rich.
He's like, it's a Star Wars poster. And I'm like, oh God. I
thought you look mad.
Like I leaned in. I was like, yeah. And then as soon as he said Star Wars poster, I was like,
hit him.
Back out.
You don't understand how close you came to getting slapped.
Back to my email.
This guy's, because all this guy does is sativa and Adderall. He's a goddamn killing machine. He's a madman all the time.
So then he tells me that Juan tells him about a poster. The Star Wars poster, and he bought it. All right, now tell me if I get the story wrong. So you bought.
Well, Juan is in our chat room right now, and Juan says, "Do not bring me into this." So I'll just
sorry,
throw
Juan.
I'm just prefacing. Two things we weren't supposed to talk about: Juan and or that your wife treats you like a roommate. People were like, "Oh, that's sad. That's actually sad." The chat room got like real serious. They're like, "Wow."
Actually, you know, you don't really yell at your roommate for not doing shit as much as you do your husband. That could be a good thing.
Not bad.
So the Star Wars poster. So he
not Star Wars. That's that was years ago. That was a failed Chinese virus movies.
So he tells me he buys the $75 Star Wars poster, and
expensive ass poster.
But now it's going.
Jenny McCarthy was like $12.99 at Spencer's
on eBay for how much? $500
There's one going $475.
Okay, $475. And then he's like, I'm just gonna wait and hold out. He's
waiting
like,
out.
By the way,
his poster is gonna buy me a house.
He's telling me like he's Mark Cuban about where he's putting his which investments he's selling and which ones he's holding, like his goddamn Amazon stock. And then he's like, I'm gonna hold it for 2 weeks, and then when it gets up right about 1,000, I'm unloading it. And then I'm like. No, you're not. I'm doubting that you're going to buy a poster for $75.
He's watching the prices. He was eBaying and yelling things. He's like, sweet Obi Kenobi's ghost. The price went up. The price went up $5 on this one.
And sell it for $1,000. I'm like, now, I'm sure there's tons of people that have done that. I'm just doubting that this, I don't know what the market is on this. And
yeah, remember when I was going to sell my Menendez brothers basketball card?
Yeah.
To fund the studio?
Yeah.
Worthless. Somebody stole it, then somebody sent us a new one.
Someone stole that one.
Oh, God.
From what I know about, like, people invest in the stock market and even gambling, I know more about gambling than that, and usually there's groups
Butler
of people.
Butler is an art collector, and you don't know anything about it. Well, he and Kramer dabble in the art world.
Well, speaking of art collectors, all the guys that do this, at least full-time hobbies or professionally, there's groups of them around the world that know exactly when, like, what valuable things are going on, like, and then buy that shit up. They have the edge. They usually...
Well, our new thing has been hot takes, correct? I'm going to throw a hot take out there, and this goes for Travis and for Kramer. Saying that you dabble in art or you're an art collector is really what you just say to us and to your wife to justify the fact that you spend a lot of money on stuff that you want to own and hang in your own house. You never sell it. You never flip it. You never do anything with it.
Yeah. Or at least we don't see the people. Like, I'm just saying.
Right? Am I right?
I have the intentions of selling it all.
Just like my theory that every woman who's married has a sewing machine, dusty sewing machine in her house somewhere.
I do not.
There are some theories that just hold true. Well, you might be the only exception.
Listen, there's a price tag for all my collectible shit that I have. And honestly, if it was, I would sell any one of them.
Then why isn't it sold?
Because I just got it yesterday. I'll flip it. I'll sell it today.
I'm just gonna put.
Oh, now you're
put
gonna
it
force
on record
him to sell it today.
That it will not be sold, and I will be extremely surprised if you even sell it for double what it's worth. And I don't know anything about Star Wars posters. And I saw you showed me the one on eBay going for that. I'm just like, but is that the true market value of this?
Is anybody watching it?
Yeah.
Is anybody bidding on it?
I don't know.
You know what I mean? Like, I can put this, beer can on eBay. Back in the day, we put Jeff L's coffee cup up there.
sold
that shit for $16.
Everybody who always tells me they have, like, some valuable item that they're going to eventually sell, and they're is waiting for it to appreciate to this amount. They're gonna say, like, I got
George Washington's teeth in a cigar box.
They always tell me how they're going to do it, but I've never seen anybody cash in. They never tell me, like, hey, I bought it for this, sold it for this. Look at it. I'm like, whoa. I mean, maybe someone has.
I have those multiple Joe Montana rookie cards. Bought them. Have yet to sell them. You know why? Because the price has fluctuated so much and nobody fucking wants them.
We have a guy online, too, that collects posters.
No, all right.
Is this Petey Posters?
This is TV Posers.
Hey, what's going on, man? Hey, thanks for calling in. So you could probably help us with some accurate expert information.
I can. So Tom is right. There are whole communities that are super invested in prints. I actually got started, you remember at the beginning of the Obama administration, Shepard Fairey did the Hope print?
Yeah, I remember it. When America wasn't great.
So I picked up that print, and now that is going for $100,000. So I'm sitting on it.
Sell it! You're an idiot!
$100,000! Get rid of it!
Get it!
Get it now!
Tom, do you have any idea how much money that's going to be worth when Obama dies?
No.
What if you die before Obama does?
Yeah, that's true.
You're waiting for Obama to die?
I'd have to see you. But are you a skinny, smoking black man?
Isn't the risk... Oh, let me ask you this.
As Obama is.
The guaranteed 100 grand now, and by the way, I, you know...
I'd sell that shit so fast. I would leave this show and sell that shit.
Not that I'm doubting you, sir.
I'd just, leave you guys just recording. Not even... I wouldn't even... I'd be like, I'm out.
I have no way to verify if it's actually worth 100 grand or not, but if it is legitimately worth 100 grand... Listen, just based on being a gambler, I take the guaranteed 100 rather than...
Well, then you're a bad gambler.
Oh, well, get them, Petey posters.
Petey, how much do you expect it to be worth?
You know Tom's serious with my dumb name stick and he's serious about it.
By the way, Obama's pretty healthy. What do you got?
I'm not expecting it to go much higher. So by the time my son is grown, I'm basically holding on to it for his college education.
Yeah, but
it's an investment, just like anything else.
Okay, but if it was a true investment, so like let's say Obama dies in 30 years. How old is Obama?
Wait a minute. So you have a print of it?
What is he?
I have an original 60? Print signed by Shepard Fairey and numbered.
Okay. So let's say you got 20 years. You would make more money by cashing it out now and putting that 100 grand into an investment. They say it doubles every 10 years in the stock market. Maybe not now, but, you know. So you could turn it into, let's say, 400 grand with a regular investment rather than wait 25 years till Obama dies and sell it for 125,000.
It must not be the one you have. But I see some on here for like 4 grand.
I just
12 grand.
I'll give you a straw hat if you could sell it for 100 grand right now. Like I'm just saying,
he can buy all the straw hats he wants if he had 100 grand.
A straw hat isn't very expensive, Tom. That's not a.
These are very rare and they're signed by Petey Poster.
All I'm saying is, I hear these claims of like this is worth 200 grand. I'm just gonna wait. I'm just like, sell it right now.
I agree with you. That you want the money, but go to some sites like there's Espresso Beans. That it's just an entire site full of people who are posting posters, trading them back and forth, selling them to each other. Because you really have to find the other fans that are, you know, as crazy as I am and spend, you know, $300 or $400 on screen printed posters a week.
So how much do you suspect your poster collection is worth, all said and done?
I have it insured right now for $500,000.
Oh my God.
What does that policy cost, by the way?
You also sound like you're masturbating while you're right now. Like, are you?
No. You're probably a little nervous, and then he gets excited when he talks posters.
When he started talking posters, I'm like, all right.
You guys actually started talking about something I know.
So, what other valuable posters do you have? You got the Obama Hope one. That's 100K. What other ones?
There's lots of Shepard Fairey stuff in there. Some Dr. Brainwash. I haven't been able to get a hold of, any real expensive, like, crazy stuff. But, you know, it's lots of little stuff. Dan McCarthy. There's lots of little niches as far as poster, especially gig posters. People want those memories, and so those things just go up and up in price as they become more rare.
Let me ask you this, Petey, because something just dawned on me.
He's part of our team now.
Yeah. You just made the list.
Because I've seen a trend here with the guys that collect, have big collections that they suppose are super valuable or whatever.
Yeah, I used to be one of those guys.
Is the satisfaction from owning the collection and theorizing the value of it and sitting on it more satisfying than the actual money it's worth and what you could do with the money?
Posters, Animal Crossing.
Like, is your lifestyle, like let's say you were able to sell your poster collection, you insured it for 500 grand, let's just say it's supposedly worth 500 grand, okay. Right? And so what you could do with 500 grand now is less... beneficial or psychologically, satisfying to you than knowing that you have the collection worth 500 grand.
I think you also have to factor in that it is more, okay, We talked about this earlier in the week, and we were talking about going on vacation. I think you'll get this analogy. And I told you that there is a sweet spot on going on vacation in a plane for me, and it's usually right after takeoff. I have a couple of beers in me, maybe some Xanax, and right when I'm in the sky. And that's the sweet spot in the anticipation of the actual trip, right?
Yeah, yeah. They said that the psychological, the anticipation of your vacation is more gratifying than the actual vacation. Yeah,
correct. Yeah. So I think that for PD Posters, it's the idea.
Or any collector.
It's the idea and the fantasy of liquidating your collection and thinking that you have X amount of dollars that you can, like, kind of get out of it is more rewarding to you than the actual reality, because the reality is that it's not going to go as smoothly as you think it is, and you probably have a bunch of worthless paper that people don't really want.
Or it's not going to be as much, and that is not going to be as gratifying.
Right. Knowing, so it's easier to hold on to it and say, no, I'm saving it. And if you're perpetually always saving it, and then you die, and then somebody else gets it, then it served its purpose because it was the fantasy.
Wait until your son sells it for 10 grand for Oxy.
Oh, come on, that's a lot of
I'm
Oxy.
Joking.
I mean, probably less than that. He probably just goes to punch it.
That's a lot. I mean, that's a two solid months for me of doing roofing.
We're just messing with you, Petey. What do you think? Do you think that owning the collection is more valuable to you
than the actual value of the collection?
Yeah.
I'll be honest. The part that, like, gets my heart thumping is the actual purchasing of the artwork, because it's like timed releases. They go on sale. If you don't get it in, like, the first 10, 15 seconds, it's gone.
So it's a thrill, like, of the hunt.
That's part of it is the thrill of the hunt.
I get in there and I just jack my poster, Peter. Good.
Do you make enough money in normal life to not have to worry about money? Or could, like, 500 grand, like, I mean, that'll buy you a beach house or maybe some awesome... toys.
I mean,
you could
go out to, like, Claremont and buy a mansion.
I do well enough that I don't have to worry about selling them.
That is a humble brag. Yes. I make more than you, Tom.
I've got a weird
Fuck
job.
Fuck you and your hair.
What's your weird job? Email me. We need you for a weird job.
I jack off on posters.
It just
and then resell them. And I resell them.
So you're right in the fact that they're only worth what someone else is willing to pay. Do you think there's someone out there willing to drop $100K on an Obama poster right now?
Oh, yeah. Like, there's people constantly looking. I know that I could sell it for $80 right now if I needed to, because there's just people looking for it at that price.
Okay, look.
So you kind of have to know.
I have mocked you and made fun of you. I have mocked you and made fun of you, but the pure delight that I hear in your voice when you talk about this poster makes me happy, and I can't deny that. And I'm glad you're into this.
Here's the thing, sir.
You got to be happy for people when they're. I mean, you can hear in his voice that he loves collecting posters.
If is there anything?
I share that same joy with all the Star Wars stuff, and you just beat me down.
you work here. You know, like, I just I got it. I gotta have something.
It's just, why is it I only hear the stories of people's value of their collection and never the stories of them actually selling any of it?
I think that because they become enmeshed, and I feel like they can't get rid of it.
Yeah, their collection
I'm one of these guys. I've got stuff. I've bought stuff before. My wife is doing a little bit of this with her Lily Pulitzer dresses that she collects, her and Maisie.
Yeah.
Some of those matching mommy and daughter dresses are very coveted, and some of the prints are extremely hard to find. And this lady hit her up and happens to have a daughter about the same size as Maisie, and then asked for this one particular print they had that has, like, states, like, all the American states, you know, on, like, represented on it. And the lady was like, I'll give you like $800 for both dresses. I'm like, fucking deal, because you bought them used. And Andrea's like, no, we're going to wait. I'm like, no, you're enmeshed.
Yeah.
You're connected to that. Yeah, sell it now because you've got a buyer.
It's worth that.
Yes,
and
now.
Who knows what it's going to be worth in the future.
Exactly.
Shepard
Fairey could end up doing something terrible. I mean, like, I had some really rare Jesse James, like, motorcycles and shit.
Right.
I did. This is a fact. I had some rare ones that I bought directly from him, right? some little diecast and shit.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That were worth a lot of money. When you start fucking Nazis, like he did, yeah, yeah. Then I gave them all to a toy drive. I gave hundreds of all of my custom little, I gave them to a toy drive for kids that don't have toys. I'm like, fucking, they're worthless.
You're one Nazi, you're playing with them. One Nazi fucking away from that poster being worth nothing. Who knows? Like, Obama fucked a Nazi today. You're like, God damn it!
Oh, my God.
That's
my whole poster. So,
I wrote Nope on it.
Can you?
That's better.
Petey, can you ruin Butler's dreams by telling him he's never going to be able to sell his nerdy Star Wars poster for $800?
Yeah, like you can bully him too. It's allowed.
Can you tell me what type it was? Is it a Gleasy or is it a four screen?
Oh, this nerd knows.
This knows guy's throwing around Gleasy four screen. I have a greasy foreskin. I should have said that. That's disgusting.
I have no fucking idea.
You're no collector.
There's the answer, there Petey. He has no idea.
I know it's a Mondo print by Scott C. Campbell.
Oh, Mondo's good. Mondo is
Scott
C.
Campbell.
Little Mondo.
Tuna Daddy says it's a silk screen, 24 by 36. Does that help you at all?
Is it numbered?
Yes.
What number do you got?
I don't fucking know.
Oh, my God.
69.
if it's numbered and it's a screen print, those will probably go up. Like, it's not a cheap print. It's if it's released by Mondo, it's probably a well-known artist. Was it the set of three that had the color differences?
Scott Campbell and... let's see. It's number. Oh no! Now you guys are. Somebody said it's number 420. So, I'm reading your fucking jokes. I'm reading your fucking jokes.
Petey, I like to ruin. Similar to.
I like to ruin everything.
Yeah, yeah. To like my stepdad's. Coin collection he was holding on to that he thought
this was a bird he loved
20 years ago
that you released into the sky.
He was like holding on to this coin collection. He's like, I got a lot of rare coins. I've been collecting them for my whole life since I was a kid in this little box. I got it, by the way. And then one day I just Google searched as many and these are worth nothing. And I ruined his dreams. Very
then
mad.
Then he released his bird. What was his bird's name?
Taz.
Taz the bird.
So
I know some valuable coins.
Anyway. And
you all right, buddy?
I have no idea if this is true, but it seems to be the case just based on what I learned about gambling from reading about it and being into it as my hobby.
Sure.
Is that the normal person that even if it's your like light hobby, you'll never be close to the people that do this full time and put like all their time into it. And there's in every industry, in every market, there's a group of people that put an insane amount of time. And those people are the ones that grab the edges the quickest. So, for instance, if there's any valuable poster out there that by the time the layman hears about it or the novice, it's already the edge is gone. Like the value is already gone because for the professionals and the people that are into it have bought it all up first and you're getting the scraps.
Do you agree with that?
100%.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So Petey knows.
Yeah, so it's like...
Yeah, it's all about the hunt. That's what I was saying. Like, you have to get it first.
Yeah, exactly.
Otherwise, it's gone. And it's just like that.
I'm just saying, when people hear a stock tip from their buddy and they like, oh, I dabble inside, like, dude, don't get into it because it's already been fucked
Butler
out.
Butler will never sell it.
The only reason you would...
Butler's never going to sell this print because... He has no interest in prints, you know? He's not keeping track of the market. He's not looking for the people who specifically want this print.
He wanted it because
fuck you, sir.
He wanted
oh, my God. Poster fight.
He wanted it because he loves Star Wars, right?
Tell him he's not going to be able to put it up on eBay 6 months from now and make $1,000. That's what he told me right before the show started. I'm like, nope, 100%, not going to happen.
And then there was a little tension. I think you actually hurt Butler's feelings a little bit.
I'm just trying to ruin his
He told me he needs to hurt your feelings more to knock him down. He's going to start doing it to everybody, too. He's done it to me. He'll do it to Sam eventually, but Sam will knock him out.
So, Petey, there's no way Butler's going to sell this on eBay for $1,000, right?
I mean, probably not, but he could. I mean, and that's
but he
like
won't,
what you're saying.
Right?
That's
so just say it. Just say it. Right? Say it,
Petey.
Yeah, yeah. It's you could say it's unlikely because he doesn't know
Tony
enough.
Tony Baloney will not sell his poster on eBay. Yeah,
because we're done here, John.
Because Petey's right. Because Petey, what he does is he knows the market, yeah. So he knows who is interested in this particular piece, who would buy it, what groups. Because there's probably groups of people that put their money together that buy stuff together.
Oh God, Juan's even saying, like Juan's just said in the Twitch chat room, they printed too many of these. It won't go for 1,000 if the run was less than 500, then maybe, but there's too much supply. So you bought a poster that Juan said there was too much supply, and you thought you were going to flip it for $1,000?
Well, there's one on eBay for $475.
Well, there's
so
a lot.
Right.
There's a pubic hair on eBay for $1 million, Tom. Yeah. I mean,
it's
like,
Obama.
It's not an accurate representation of the market.
That ain't accurate.
So, all right, Petey. Oh, what other posters you got that are worth anything besides Obama?
There's a lot of, I follow a couple of very specific artists. There's Dan McCarthy. He's a big one. Martin Anson. He does a lot of work with Mondo. There's names that you guys just will never know, but mean a really big deal to the people who do follow this every single day. So, you know, it's what you guys do. It's following all the betting podcasts and, you know, there's, if you look for it, there's print podcasts.
Are you like familiar with Matt Ferguson?
People who just are
finding
these posters.
Butler's trying to throw some knowledge out. Do you know who Matt Ferguson is?
Matt Ferguson?
Yeah.
He's an artist?
Goddamn, never mind.
It's nobody, sir. Butler thought he's a big deal, and that's obviously a poster he bought that's worth nothing. You know what's interesting, Petey? What's interesting is...
Are you familiar with Matt Ferguson?
It seems like all the people that buy this stuff
are stupid.
Well, they're looking to sell it to the ultra-rich because they've got the...
expendable cash.
Yeah, the cash is just...
But the only people that care about this garbage are poor people.
Or, you know, just like the super collector nerds that track this, and then they'll... the white whale, they'll sell to some like real estate investor in Manhattan that just, you know, they have $100 million and they'll just buy ridiculous shit for super expensive because they want some Star Wars poster or the Obama poster in their little study or whatever. Mm-hmm. And they'll be willing to pay for $100. So those people, how do you get to those people to sell your expensive posters? Like, are those people looking on
the... Yeah, finding the outlets. Sometimes just getting rid of the merchandise is the hardest thing. I see this in all the jewelry heist movies.
Where do the ultra-rich shop for this garbage?
Jesus.
So the guy who got me into the print collecting and stuff, he does this out of his home now. It's his full-time job, but it's a quote-unquote art studio. And he sells and buys prints and does this all the time, but because he's selling so much, you know, he's got relationships with art brokers and people who have a little bit more money, and so a lot of it is about who you know and how you can unload it. So,
yeah. So this is like a Tiger King meth and making straight men gay scenario.
Well, it's...
Oh, I'm sure that there's a Netflix documentary coming out about print making anytime soon and collecting.
Yeah, it's just like any business. You have certain clients that you get relationship with, and then so you get a piece, and then you're like, oh, Joe will be interested in this, and you email.
Good buddy that used to DJ at Latitude. Remember, did Big Belly Trivia with me? You know Josh. He's an art broker. That's what he does. So he's like, oh, I got in this copper fountain that was done by this one lady in L.A. I know this guy out at Islesworth that, you know, has a house that, and he collects copper art statues.
Yeah.
He'd love this. Calls in, the guy's like, absolutely, I'm in. And then he comes down. He brokers the deal. It's crazy.
Matt, Cabin Boy Matt, does with houses and shit. He knows a bunch of investors. Yep. Like, he sees a deal.
And you know what they like, you know, their interest, what they're into. And if something, and you give them the first right of refusal.
It just takes a lot of work, just like anything.
Because then your job is the network, not necessarily the art. Yes. It's just the relationship with the person. Exactly, I get it.
Those relationships get so big that, like, my friend had one of these artist posters do his, you know, wedding invitations and that sort of stuff. So you really do. It's a relatively small community, so you get to know a lot of people and you can make your name pretty quickly. And
what's
so
cool,
Petey? Can you do one favor for me? And I mean,
no,
I'll kill you.
Hey.
I like getting so mad. Anyway, I just just as an experiment to prove me wrong, Petey. Just prove me wrong, because there's
That's the easiest thing. My God,
easiest favor ever.
Wait, are you gonna bet to prove me wrong? You need to focus it to me.
No. Not in this doesn't go to anybody else.
Okay, this is you and Petey
just
Posters.
Me and Petey Posters. I just want you. Okay, go through your collection and just find one that's worth like $5,000 to $8,000, right? And then sell that on the market just a little bit.
Oh, you're gonna make him liquidate his collection?
No, just one piece.
No, I've got some that I could unload.
Yeah. Just unload that and then go buy a jet ski and then send me the picture and be like, I unloaded this. Poster and bought this awesome jet ski.
But he does well enough to probably just go buy a jet ski and he'll just lie to you.
No, but I want the...
I don't trust anybody whose last name is Posters.
You show me that and then I'll be proven wrong and I'll be like, oh, he sold his poster, bought a jet ski, he made enough profit, and that's it. You know, and then...
Juan's already told you he's done this. Juan sold his poster collection and funded his honeymoon.
Yeah, that's true.
I didn't see any honeymoon pictures. I'd have to see how the honeymoon was, because they might have experienced a great honeymoon, but if I'm there, I'd be like, this is fucking Bobo.
Yeah. Like, what did he do? Did he ride jet skis?
What did he do? I'd have to see the hotel room. I'd have to see the pool amenities, the bar.
I'm like most white trash. Once you get to the level of riding a jet ski, I'm like, you've made it.
Yeah, I think that too. Wow. Also, it's the first thing that pops into my mind whenever you write me a check and you hand it to me. I'm like, jet ski.
Yeah.
Every single time. It's happened for the last 10 years.
Wait, it's an ongoing joke we have with our accountant.
Bernie doesn't like that joke anymore. Neither does Elizabeth, who's his right-hand gal.
Yeah.
She does not like the jet ski joke when she's like, I'm sending you the receipt for the payment, and I'm like, jet ski. She's like, please stop replying to these emails.
Yeah. So, Petey, if you could do that in the next, during this summer, I'll give you some time. Just buy it.
I'll tell you what, I'll get it to you by the end of next month.
All right. What are you going to buy? You know, I mean, it could be jet ski. It could be
buy a real doll.
I'm looking at buying a Subaru. I could use that as a pretty hefty down payment.
WRX?
This guy's a manipulator. He knows how to get to you, and he thinks if he's going to start throwing around other clients, he's going to be able to hyper-focus you a little more.
Well, I need it to be...
And he's right.
I need it to be somewhat elaborate and not like a... Because you sound, a little too rational, Petey, where you're not going to go out and buy a WRX.
You got to buy like something crazy. You got to buy like 100,000 Hot Pockets or something. You got to do something dumb.
Get that mid-engine Corvette from Don.
Yeah. Get that.
I want something just ridiculous. So then I could be like,
Get that Subaru, that factory custom Silverado, the Black Widow.
Oh, yeah. Something where...
Should I finally invest in a one-wheel?
You sound like a one-wheel guy with your fucking nerd voice.
It's
like, because these two fucking nerds here.
Let's go out. Oh, look at me. I'm sidewalk surfing.
They call it
Dan, am I going to see you on Animal Crossing later?
You'll definitely see me on there. I'm a nerd, too. I'll be there.
All right, Petey, thanks for calling in. It was pretty interesting. Send me
this
that proof.
This guy's
great. Yeah.
Will do. Nice talking to you guys.
All right, nice talking to you, too, man. Have a good weekend. He's awesome. I like that guy.
Yeah.
Oh, Petey Posters.
We added to our hour team.
There are a lot of things. Like, people get into this, like, these groups, and, like, the more and more you get into them... and I think everybody dabbles with it, especially now with
I'm like
Facebook.
A daywalker. I just kind of
tiptoe. Like I'm in a hurricane.
Don't backpedal now. I feel your confidence slipping. Don't let him knock your confidence down.
Oh, I have a portfolio. I'm gonna unload.
Yeah, this weekend I wanted to bother you so bad that he called you out on the show that you knee jerk reaction, full frog freak out, sell your poster immediately for whatever you can get for it.
I
got face value.
Yeah, exactly. I broke even, you motherfucker.
I'll bring this up before the break.
Uh-oh.
So I feel like it's long enough where he wouldn't still listen.
Oh, 9/11?
No, on Monday's BDM show, which, by the way, you can, if you haven't listened to, you can go back and listen to, it's the 420, We All Got High.
Yeah.
And did about an hour and a half. So during that show, I told you about the guy that's living in the house.
Homeless
that,
Harry Potts.
Yeah, homeless Harry Potts.
Yeah.
He's living in a house that some, like his, I guess, his boss, some investor bought. He's flipping, and this guy, I guess, lives in the house and fix it up. Like,
don't feel bad, like, but you are our homeless Harry Potts.
And I guess this is a thing, so investors will buy a house, then put their, like, a handyman, like a homeless handyman that, like, needs a place to live, and while he's living there, he just, you know.
Right, he fixes the place up.
Yeah, he fixes it up, but mainly, like, doing
God
some.
God damn it, I am your fucking
pressure washer.
Take the trash out, Mr. Tom.
And so this guy,
thank you, Butler.
He's been talking to me for about a couple months now because I'm outside a lot.
I can't believe you talk to homeless people.
Anyway, you'll hear the story on the BDM show.
Weird.
So yesterday I brought my boat to in front of my house because I'm working on it.
Let me guess. He needs a boat.
No. But
let me clean your propeller.
So I was working on it yesterday.
What does that mean, working on it?
Yeah, it means basically he's high pacing back and forth inside the boat.
Okay.
I just, like, with me and my scooter, it took all of 5 minutes to bolt the exhaust on. Andrew's like, what are you doing out here? I'm like, just walking in circles around it high and drinking a beer.
I thought that I could attempt to put a new marine stereo in there and unscrew it out of the wires. I was like,
look at this,
like,
guy, DJ Magic Mike over here, everybody.
I was like, why did I think I could do this? There's so many wires all corroded.
You put a bazooka tube in there, bro.
And then I looked at the shit I bought. I'm looking at, I'm like, I have no idea. I just put it back. And then I'm like, fuck! I ruined it. So anyway.
You seemed so confident yesterday.
Yeah.
How am I supposed to listen to Turn Down for what?
By the way, when I was unscrewing the screws to pull it, I had no idea what I was doing.
Then why were you unscrewing them? God damn it, man.
Because in my mind, once.
You make me so mad. If you saw how I approached putting the exhaust on my scooter, I laid a blanket out. I parked my bike. I cleaned the bike, the area. I laid every tool I needed out in a row in the order that they would be used.
Yeah.
That's how different we are.
Not me. I ordered the new.
It was
new,
like a mystery as soon as he took the screws out. Like,
yeah. Are these even screws? I don't know.
I had no idea. The stereo I ordered was wrong.
We have a guy in the chat room that can install a stereo for you.
No, that's what I'm talking
we
about.
We want. Okay, what do you want?
It's Steve stereo.
It's a detachable face blah punk, and he's got two bazooka tubes, and he wants to put bass blockers in the front so his tweeters are extra tweeting.
Well done, Tom. That was under 2 minutes.
Oh, my God.
By the way,
I know. It's an all-time record.
The shit that I bought is not even a brand I recognize. Oh, something like,
would you buy Realistic?
Is this a thing you bought off like a Facebook ad that you didn't know was legit?
Oh, my God. What'd you buy?
I didn't know you were well-versed in marine audio.
Yeah. Two times smaller than the normal.
Oh, you got it off Wish?
Tiny little computer speakers. He tried to put some old HP.
For an RC car?
He put some old HP computer speakers on there. Plug it in so I can hear.
The whole entire thing.
I can't hear my Limp Bizkit.
Fits in the hole, the old one. Like, I could just put it in there. It's like, this is wrong. Anyway, so.
He bought some old Bobo-ass speaker.
Homeless Potts comes walking back from Walmart again.
Oh,
and then,
here it comes.
And then so.
Hey, crank up, play some Gatlin Brothers.
By the way, I saw him coming and I intentionally, like, ducked down then started.
I see you hiding in your boat.
I started.
I can see your hair. It's real poofy. It's real big.
Yeah, I scrubbed
Don't
the
lie.
Deck.
You waved him down like Forrest Gump.
No, I know. I saw him
come
coming.
Over here. Check out this booming system of pulled land. Got two bazooka tubes. He'll rock your fucking tits off.
Then he just stops at the sidewalk and then starts talking to him. I was like, fuck.
Oh,
I know you're in there.
And then so
I can see you.
So I go, and then he starts telling me about all this shit. I'm like, God damn it. So I think to myself that, like, pretending to be busy would cause him to move along, but that doesn't. It doesn't work for him. No. He just keeps talking. Then he tells me that he's like, oh, yeah, thanks for the pots, Tom. I appreciate it. I'm like, yeah, no problem. He's like, I
sold him for tons of money on eBay with some art.
He's like, I gave him to my boss's wife.
And I'm like, and I fucked it good.
Oh, man. Don't tell Crystal that.
No. And then I'm like, have you told Crystal that?
Why? I was like, the boss that buys investment properties and resells them. Like, yeah, he can buy some goddamn pots. And I imagine.
By the way, that's what your wife said when she called in.
His rich.
That's the exact phrase.
Yep.
his rich wife doesn't want your homeless bum pots. Like, she probably potted...
Well, technically, they were your homeless
bum pots. I know. So. But they came from him, so I imagine... Mm-hmm. And I'm pretty sure that's a lie. Why are you telling me this? This is... And, like...
Well, he's crazy, Tom.
I know. That's where I boiled it down to. I was like,
you gotta create some boundaries.
I mean,
here.
There's mental illness there. You know that.
Yeah.
Everybody that lives under the street is mental, including you. You just don't want
to
admit
it. He doesn't even realize it.
Everybody under the street. Okay, let's just do that. I
wonder what your nickname is to everybody else in the neighborhood.
Crazy Tom. Everybody knows that. Right, crazy Paul. Yeah, Crazy Paul Van.
It's the Twitch, the BDM. They make fun of me. I know. I see it.
Well, no, but like people, like name one normal person on your block.
Well, who's really normal?
Black lady with a steak knife.
She moved.
Hawaiian tropic lady. Cat addicted normal. Man. Raccoon man.
Dr. Ghoul.
Dr. Ghoul. Yeah,
they're all normal. I just, they're characters in my
MMA, Army
life.
Ranger. He moved out, right?
Yeah, you got to be Rambo Tommy. You always got your red headband on.
Yeah, that's
always,
true.
If they had podcasts, they'll talk shit about me. They'll be like, this guy.
That's amazing, Jonathan's son.
He pulls his boat up to it and parks in his yard. And fucking,
then he lays down in there, Jackson. I seen him.
I think he's just hiding from his family because he's just wandering around his boat.
You know,
like,
I've never seen
it off.
That boat's never been in the water. That's his car boat. That's a two-wheel car.
You know what? Crazy people do buy things and start living in them eventually. Yeah.
Sailboats.
I'm on my way.
That's why I always laughed when you always said your dream was a sailboat. Oh. Everybody I know that lives in a sailboat, the sailboat never goes anywhere. It's just a floating house.
Yeah.
Want to take a break?
Let's take a break.
Yeah, let's do it. I got brand new music from Fake Names is the name of the band. These guys are really good. 1-844-TOMNDAN if you want to call in. Show at TomandDan.com if you would like to throw us an email. We'll be right back. The name of the song, First Everlasting. Whispering shadows, whispering to me to let it in, man corrupted. That is the Pack AD. The name of the song is It's Okay. It's got kind of this Queens of the Stone Age, like Foo Fighters, like a groovy vibe. Or remember... What was it? What was the name of that band? Something Vultures that had... Those Damn Vultures. Is that what it's called?
I don't think
it was Dave Grohl, and then it was John Paul Jones from Led Zeppelin on bass, and then... Yeah, it was like... But it's kind of... Them Crooked Vultures, but it's kind of got that groovy, almost like traditional rock and roll vibe to it. So anyway, I dig it. But welcome back to the show. This is A Mediocre Time with Tom and Dan. I'm Dan.
Tom.
Samantha, our producer, and Butler is here.
So we got some new merch on the site. We got Eric Pabon-inspired shirt.
I'm wearing that today.
A Rat Fink, me riding a one wheel, Dan riding a scooter. A variation of our 10-year logo that Danger Brain did.
I love that logo.
It's cool. Both t-shirts are up on the site right now, and some side chick stuff. Stickers,
White Claw
koozies,
stickers, and there's a pop socket involved in one of those packs.
Yeah, man, these pop sockets. It's like this one, right?
Yeah, it's that one.
The Tom and Dan like surf or beach logo. These are great. I used to make fun of pop sockets incessantly and make fun of people that had them until I put one on my phone. I was like, this is fantastic.
Well, so much easier to hold. Like, especially with one hand, if you're laying down, like, you have to have it. You know what I'm saying?
I guess so.
You're laying on the couch or the bed, you're looking at your phone.
No, I know. everybody knows what you're talking about. You're jacking off.
Jenna Hurt's calling us right now.
Jenna Hurt, what's up?
Back to you.
Hey, baby, what's shaking? We haven't talked to you in a minute.
Oh, yeah. I know. I miss you guys.
We miss you too. How you doing?
I'm good. I'm up in New Hampshire, quarantining with my boyfriend at his parents' house here.
There you go. I know what that means.
Yeah, it's good.
So, Jenna, I was thinking about you the other day, specifically.
Yeah, he was holding his phone with a pop socket. Yeah, laying down on the couch.
Just
motherfucker, what is wrong with
that
you?
That pop socket.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
The Jenna Hurt pop socket. I'll change the heading of it tonight to say the Jenna Hurt official pop socket.
And you know how they've been talking about, like, for some people that never leave their house, they're like, well, nothing's changed for me. Right. As usual, like, I just stay at home.
There.
Never leave anyway, so nothing's changed. And so when I'm reading that, I then think of the people that
are addicted to traveling.
Well, yeah, and you can't hold them down, and they constantly want to move. They're, they're Roman.
Or maybe their whole charity component of how they live their life is kind of dependent upon them moving and then taking skateboards to third world countries to assist. Letting young girls, especially, and boys, but mostly girls, learn how to skate and maybe escape the poverty and horrible, oppressive lifestyle that they live in.
You're a rambling woman, so is it hitting you hard?
You are a rambling man.
You know, it's kind of funny because I have two aspects to myself, I think, really. I'm a Libra. I'm sort of all in or I'm not. Or I'm extreme or I'm, so I have the ability, honestly, to be inside a house just making jewelry all day, like totally fine. Like it's, I could do that, you know. What is kind of a little bit depressing through all this is really thinking for, just real quick. So in January was the last, maybe the last time ever. I feel like I've got a little Debbie Downer, but really it seems a little crazy to think that I would be traveling to developing countries in super impoverished places where there's lots and lots and lots of people in tightly packed, 10, 12, 15 people staying in one little room. Dirt streets together, no running water. Kids without shoes, everybody wants to touch you, me, everybody, because, you're white or you got a skateboard or you're new and they're a little village. I mean, it's crazy to think that when will that ever happen again? I really am not quite sure. But in January, I was lucky. That was the last time that I went, and I'm glad that I did. I went to Tanzania in January for about a month, and I helped build a skateboard park at an orphanage for 25 girls, brought them skateboards and taught them how to skate and have this relationship with them now. It's been very, very sweet through times of, being isolated. I don't know when I'll be able to do that again. It's just kind of kind of crazy.
I feel confident that, I don't think things will go back to exactly how they were, because I think there are some lessons and things that needed to be learned there, and obviously there will be a process in that. But I think you will get to go and do what I honestly believe is your calling, which is to go to these countries that need you and let you put some smile on children's faces by kind of giving them the beauty and the structure of the sport that is skateboarding. I really believe that.
Yeah.
The irony,
I don't think it's over for you at all. So don't get too down. I think it's easy to get down right now.
Also, the irony is that plane tickets cheap right now.
Oh, man. You could go.
I can talk about investing.
Even cargo.
Investing in your future.
Even
you
want to
fly to Australia? $13.
Yeah, exactly.
$13.
Yeah. And why? Well, I got to bring 700 skateboards. Ah, it's an extra $5. It's like not a big deal at all. Like most of. Isn't that
skateboard gets a chair?
Isn't that like the hardest thing for you though, is like paying the shipping cost of getting all your gear out there, because you're putting together hundreds of skateboards?
It is a lot of money for sure to get. Like, so when I went to Tanzania to bring, I brought 25 boards there for these girls, and I had to, not only the hundreds of pounds of boards by myself, getting it on an Uber to the plane and then the plane, and then I stayed in, I think, Germany the first night. I had a layover, but I had to. The layover was too long. It was 10 hours, so they had to give me all my boxes back. So I couldn't carry these boxes, so I had to take them in an Uber and then get a hotel and then get them into the hotel and then 4 hours, 5 hours later, come bring them back to the airport to recheck them. It's that kind of stuff. It's kind of expensive kind of way.
Real quick. I'm on your Facebook page for Donate for Skate. And
nice.
And I'm putting it up there so everybody can see it. Apologize my coughing. But I saw you and a little girl skating on a ramp, and I believe you're in the Seychelles Islands. And that comes up all the time on here, but not the impoverished
Guy.
Like, hey, we're children and we need help. Seychelles,
that rich prince.
I saw him when I was there.
What?
How'd you see him?
Did you go to one of these orgies?
Well, so, no. Damn. I had kind of paid this guy to take me around the island that day to find that skate park because nobody knew where it was. And I happened to be there, and I happened to have my board, and so he helped me find it. And then he also took me to this area that, you know, was a little bit more upscale, you know, and that he pointed, he said, that's the king guy or whatever. Like, he pointed it out, and there, he had a whole entourage, and there was, like, champagne and everything, like, all on the table. Like, he was, you know, I was like, oh, okay. But I didn't know or, you know, I was like, oh, yeah, cool, whatever. And then
guy,
I've always heard you guys talk about him, and I always just kind of giggle, you know?
Well, that guy, I mean, talking about getting some skateboard parts. I mean, that guy could buy you some fucking skateboard parts.
I know. Yeah. Hey, you know what I was calling? I have this really kind of funny thing that happened last night, and I want to know what you guys think.
Okay, please. Yeah, you look, we're trying to get back to normal, so a Jenna Hurt tangent call is as normal. Yeah. This is as normal as we could get. Let's go.
Okay. So, I'm gonna set the scenario up. This is a conversation between my boyfriend and I last night, okay? About a half-hour-long conversation, okay? And is it left brain? Is it right brain? Is it guy? Is it girl? Is it just, what is it? Okay, so I'm going to set up the scenario, and then you guys say your answers, and then we'll kind of go from there, right?
Okay, that's fair.
Okay. So and this is kind of like all those, like, meme things that are going around, like, oh, 3 + 3 = leaf. Like, all these, like, and you know what I mean? Like, try to figure out, everybody has a different way of looking at things, you know? It's that kind of thing,
okay,
right?
Okay, all right.
Okay, so we're thinking about refinishing the exterior of his parents' house because we're here, okay, and his parents want us to do it, and we can, okay. So, but we had a conversation last night about, like, the process. You know, what are we going to do? What's going to happen first? Whatever. So we got to the part where we're going to talk about doing the Tyvek, you know, wrapping the
Tyvek
exterior of the house for water barrier.
Sure.
Okay? Tom, you're going to like this one. Tom, you got to ask Crystal this when you get home, too, this question. Okay, so pretend you're steering at the front of a house, okay? The left-hand side of the house is the neighbor's side. The back side of the house is the back side of the house. The right-hand side of the house is a street, okay? That's our visual, okay? So we're both staring at the front of the house. And we say, okay, we're going to wrap the house in Tyvek left to right. We're going to wrap the house left to right all the way around. Wrap, okay? A roll of Tyvek. Or pretend it's a roll of Saran wrap, okay?
Sure, yeah.
Which way do you start wrapping the house? Do you wrap it clockwise or counterclockwise?
Counter.
Which way
counter
is left to right?
I'm going clockwise.
I go left-hand side. I start on the left-hand side, and then I bring the Tyvek across the front.
Yeah. Oh, the front?
And then I go down the right, and then I go down the back, and then I go up the left, and that's my first pass.
See,
in my mind, I was like, when you said start on the left-hand side, I start on the left and then go to the back, then go to the right-hand street side, then the front. I'm going clockwise.
So
I'm with Tom.
Okay, so
that's going, we're wrapping, me and Tom are going to wrap clockwise. Daniel, you're wrapping counterclockwise, and so are you, Sam?
Yes, correct.
Yeah, why, just out of curiosity, probably
okay,
you
have
no
answer.
Now
think about this.
Well, Butler, let's have Butler. Butler's getting passed over. Unless you're just mad at him.
He said counter as well.
Oh, you said counter as well? So you're with me and Sam.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Okay. Now, this is after a half-hour conversation. Chris got out the fucking toilet paper roll, okay? And this is when I finally realized we're literally looking at it two different ways, but they're both right. Think about this. Me and Tom are thinking we're looking at the house, and we're going to wrap it left to right. So we're going left to the neighbors, to the back of the house, to the street, to the front. We're going clockwise. Me and Tom are thinking it's kind of like a 3D scenario. You guys, Daniel and Sam, you're kind of looking at a face wall, straight up reading a book, left to right.
Right.
So you're
yes.
going counterclockwise.
Mm-hmm.
But they're both right.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
Jenna.
You know what I mean? But is it guy, girl? Is it left brain, right brain? How do you, this is the thing, how funny.
Okay, well, normally.
Human.
We're meant to be together. That's all I've heard.
Man, Tom is obsessed with Jenna. Ever since that cartoon.
We should.
This guy's horny, and he grew his hair out for you.
Yeah, he was really upset when he heard you had a boyfriend.
We're both clockwise.
When you said, I have a question about my boyfriend, and he slid a paper over to me, and he said, hang up.
You know what's so funny? The last time I was in, I was talking about the motorcycle trip, you know, and Tom was like, we were talking about, like, oh, you can't tame me. Mm. So then Swervy did that cartoon, like, yeah. about, like, taming me. Like, oh, God, you got to leave in the morning, you know.
Yeah.
And it's so funny because my boyfriend, he literally laughs about that, like, I tamed you.
No. See, that's
he
where...
said he could tame her better than you, Tom.
This guy did the only thing you think you can't do, Mr. Overly Confident.
You are a wild stallion. You do, there's
yeah. You need a boring old pepper dad.
You can't. I'll let you run free, Jenna.
He doesn't care about anything. You can fuck other dudes. Yeah, you can do anything you want with Tom. He cares about his cantaloupe.
Conspiracy theory that he engineered this COVID to keep me tame here in the house.
Yeah, listen, I know you got to let the horses run sometimes.
What does that mean?
And you're not meant to be tame, Jenna. You're with a boyfriend. He's trying to break you. I've seen it. They get you in the pen.
I don't think that's how it works. I don't know. Are you talking about cuckold again? And
then they go up to you and they're petting your snout. And then you're resist that
I don't
first.
Know what that means.
The next thing you know, he's riding you, and then you're
and he's digging his spurs in hard.
And then you're on some
you're
sort
going
of
going counterclockwise,
some sort of ranch, and you're taking fat British tourists down the mountain. And
you weren't born to do that. Yeah, and then every night you go home, and there's not even accurate there's not even real food for you to eat. He gives you a handful of candy corn.
You're a wild stallion, Jenna. You're meant to run.
Tom's dream is for you to skateboard and him to have his one wheel right beside you, hand in hand.
Tom's dream is for Jenna to somehow parachute out of a plane with no parachute, fall through his ceiling, killing his wife, landing on her, killing her, and then becoming
like
becoming his new wife just based on some sort of fucked up airplane falling law.
I'll go with you. Now, we got to take our boys because I love them.
Leave the crow. It's like fucking Godfather. Take the cannoli. Right? Leave the crow.
But I just feel this is slowly killing your heart.
You know,
every time
you start bringing this up.
It is. Okay. I got to say, you guys, this is the most conversation I've had in the last month with anybody other than my boy. I've kind of avoided talking. I've been a little Debbie Downer. All my art shows, think about it. I sell my jewelry for a living.
Yeah, they're all canceled.
I'm literally touching people, putting jewelry around their necks, or I might as well be French kissing them. When is that going to happen again? It's crazy. It's a crazy thought, you know?
I mean, I don't think I've ever... How long have I known you? 15 years?
Yeah, at least.
At least, you know? I don't think I've ever heard you sad.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever heard you say
it. I know. It's been a weird thing because it's like I'm like wandering around a dark forest. Who am I?
Well, you need to get a motorcycle again and ride around with Tom. That'll cheer you up. If that doesn't cheer you up, his constant boner poking you in the back. I mean, at least you'll be good and sexually harassed.
Well, that's a problem. I'm not a wild stallion myself. So,
no boners anymore? You're just 38. Man,
the sex
is
extremely boring.
What's happening? My
quiet, commander style. Yeah, not good. Yeah. But everything else.
She's not like that. She's a stallion.
I'll let you run. I know. Yeah. But me, I can't keep up.
Yeah, but what if she wants you to run with her?
Well, I could do it for a little bit. But it's not long.
What if she's like, come on, give me more? Because I've had girls tell me that, and I'm like, I got nothing left.
You know how you grab the, what is it, the reins of the horse and
the
you're
bridle?
Yeah, like, you're like, it's okay, it could be.
Whoa, girl. It's all right.
It goes back, yeah. And then they put the saddle on, and then you're done.
Yeah, then you're done.
Well, Tom, you have to ask Crystal this scenario. He'll never do that.
Okay. He tries not to talk to her as least as possible. Yeah, if she
ask her scenario, you're crazy.
I guarantee.
You start a fight.
Tom gets home, and she's like, happened. "What happened on the show today? Did anybody have anything they wanted you to ask me?" And he's like, "Absolutely not.
Nothing happened.
Daniel wasn't even there. We didn't even record.
Some Petey poster, some shit. I don't know.
Fucking suck. I'm checking the sun draws. I'm scared. I'm really scared."
All right, Jenna. Well, it was good talking to you.
I miss you guys.
And we miss you too.
We'll give you a call, Tom, especially.
He really misses you. Yeah. He misses the. He misses your the touch of your mouth.
Where's a remote place that we can run away to, Jenna?
Like
some place with no corona. That's like, you know, where was that?
Every place in the Caribbean has corona.
You know that where Leonardo DiCaprio lived in the beach?
No, where they chopped the people's hands off.
Thailand.
Island.
Then when someone gets bit by a shark, we'll put them out of the tent, and we're like, we're tired of hearing them scream.
I hate living on Thailand Island.
Then there's a bunch of weed with a little shoot.
Fifi Lay.
You think there's corona there?
I think I scuba dove there, actually. It was some little island off.
She scuba dives, Tom. Did you even know that Jenna Hurts scuba dives? Does that give you even more of a quarter inch
that island's closed to tourists now?
Hey, Tom. What? Tom, the first place that I ever scuba dove was in Iceland.
Really? God damn.
It was too cold. The
first place I ever scuba dived was some shit lake. Like literally right down the road.
There was an old Winn-Dixie
fucking shopping cart in there with a turtle inside. He's like, this is my house. This is my house. Leave me alone.
You got to check that place out. It's pretty cool. It's called the Siffa Crack, and it's you can scuba dive.
Don't ever tell Tom to sniff your crack. He'll do it.
No.
You said, Tom, sniff my crack. All door.
So, Jenna, last question to you, because I often...
The chat room wants to weigh in. They said your poof is growing. Like you have a hair, you have a hair erection.
Poof boner.
Yeah, you have poof boner.
You got a Conan going on.
So,
Conan boner.
Jenna, do you think like this too? Because I often look at the internet and I see like... these Facebook, like 10 secret hideaways that no one knows about.
We wrote about this article that goes to millions.
So you see these things, and it's kind of like why you can't really go to Blue Springs in the summer anymore, because it's too packed because everybody knows. And like Devil's Den and all these little.
Oh, Devil's Den has been fucked up.
Like all these cool Florida places.
That's where I found the dinosaur vertebrae.
Yeah.
The Devil's Den.
It was all these like
except it was a toilet urinal.
That'd be the only problem with me living with Jenna. Like, I can't get a word in.
She's crazy.
But that's what makes her good at all the other stuff. She doesn't bitch at me,
but goddamn, she's always got something going on. I miss my crow.
I'm used to the crow.
I wonder if Crow remembers me. Let me see if I call her.
At least I was like, oh,
hello, Crow.
Hello, Crow.
Let me check in. Still mad? All right. Things are normal. Jenna's all over the place.
I don't know what I want. Do I love the crow or do I love the bitch? I don't know what I want. It's a bizarre love triangle. Joy Division.
Tell you what, the stallion. Oh, it's good and bad, though.
Yeah. The crow, what, Jenna? I'm sorry. It's easier with the crow. Good day.
The crow's an angry missionary.
I have to leave you and do inflamed, angry missionary.
So, Anyway, back to him.
Here's your washcloth, bro.
back to Facebook.
So when I see these things, I was like, ah, you're ruining it because you're telling the world about these cool places.
Don't say, well, keep your mouth shut. Not everything you're has to be broadcast the place on the
with
fucking
the internet.
I know.
And half the time, you don't want people to tell anybody where the secrets are, and then the other half, you're like, put all the secrets on the internet. Then you don't have to go anywhere. You can just look at a video of it.
I know.
Make up your mind.
Here's the thing. I want them just to look on the internet, not to show up. But when I show up at these places, it's just everybody knows about it.
Can I point out an observation? I need to point out an observation that I'm feeling with Jenna right now, and I felt it yesterday with Tiffany. We are getting calls from our best friends in the world, Tiffany Martin, Jenna Hurt. These are friends of the show that like literally are my best friends in the world. We're getting calls from them, and they're staying on the line for like a really long time because they're not talking to fucking anybody.
Right.
And they need to talk to people.
People got
to
get it out.
Yeah, people got to get it out. I can feel it from you right now, man. Like, I can feel that you have words that are like, you're constipated with words.
So I do have a pointed question. So going back to
that. Do you love my
my bone is pointed.
Going back to like all these secrets.
How big is Chris? Can I beat him up?
Have you experienced that in your past travels, Jenna, where you went to some place, let's say like 15 years ago, then you went again like 5 years ago, and it was totally fucked out with tourism and overcrowdedness and stuff like that?
You know what's funny about those Facebook things and stuff? Like, I'll have been to places, and then somebody will send me those. You know, can you guys still hear me? My earbuds just died.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, cool. There was this one place on like the Huayna Pinchu, like it was called the Death Stairs in Peru, like in Machu Picchu.
Yeah.
You pay for like this extra sort of ticket where there's only 200 people a day that are allowed to go up on the side of this ridge of Machu Picchu where it's just this rock.
It looks terrifying.
Sort of very, I mean, to some people, for sure.
Yes, to anyone.
You know.
I'm looking at it. You're crazy if you do this.
There were panicking girls. The craziest thing about that was that my buddy and I were together doing this, and we physically had to help these two girls down because they were hyperventilating.
I wouldn't even have got out there. This looks crazy as hell.
But it was cool, but, you know, it's like, I don't know. It just all depends, you know, but I think mostly people just kind of look at that and think like a dream, and it always makes me super mad because my whole thing all the time is like, what, go? What is holding you back? You have a 2-week vacation. Look, here's a ticket for $400. I'll book it for you. Like, I will literally I would love to see my friends. You know, in the past, I don't know, this is my Debbie Downer, will this ever happen again? But, you know, travel to somewhere and do something that they think is some beautiful place. Just go. I mean,
So Jenna, your theory is people see this on Facebook, but never act and just dream about it.
It's so unattainable, you know, and I do understand that people have kids and jobs, but they do have time. At one point or another, they do have the time, and I feel like people, I've always felt like people think that it's so unattainable to do certain things, and I just never saw it as that. And even just looking outside the picture of their life, I could see that they can do it. They just never would feel like it was something that they could attain. For some reason, like it's just some Facebook thing that they want to dream about, and maybe that's just what they like to do, and that's okay too. But
maybe it's a dream.
This is the vibe of the whole show. It's like the collection.
Yeah.
It ties in perfectly. The dream of liquidating the poster collection is bigger in your own mind
than actually doing it.
It might even serve a purpose that's bigger than actually liquidating the collection.
Yeah, so dreaming about going to somewhere like that European.
Like poster collectors are the world's worst travelers.
Yeah. It's also like maybe that dream European vacation is keeping them going, and they're afraid to actually go on it because they've been dreaming about it for 20 years, and then if they go on it and it's not as good as they thought it was, then it's going to ruin it.
And chances are it won't be because your expectations and, you know, the adrenaline and, you know, everything, the anticipation of even being there. Yeah.
That's a sad thought.
Well, this is that's a really sad thought. But I mean, so where are you and Tom going to run away to when this is all said and done?
I don't know. I still think we should do the motorcycle off the cliff.
I wish you guys would
do that. And Louisa.
When it's all about to hit the fan.
I mean, I'd only want to do it if you're both nude. That way, at least I got something out of it.
And
I wouldn't do it nude, Daniel.
I would do it nude. Yeah.
No, she said you think she wouldn't do it.
Oh, I know she would. I'm just saying, you know, anytime I get a chance to see really adventurous women nude, I'm always down. not down.
By the way, we will both be nude, and I'll be riding bitch, and I'll jump off at the last second because I'll puss out.
And you roll.
Got a boner! I got rocks in my boner.
Then I'm like, fuck, I gotta walk out of here. What wow. Like, shorts.
She's really burning good over there. Wow, isn't it? Holy shit, I have a lot of fuel in that tank.
All right, Jenna.
I can smell the pubes.
It was good talking to you.
Good. You guys.
We miss you. And hey, let us know next time you're in town.
Definitely.
All right.
Love you guys.
We love you. Yeah, tell Chris we'll said hey, and we'll talk to you soon, okay?
All right.
Bye, Mama. Take care. Oh, that's the only time I've ever heard her sad.
She can't travel.
Yeah, I know. That's like her thing. That's like her
really, you know.
Dude, it's her heart. That's like her love.
It's her
like
whole life.
You shut that down. I was just scrolling through her Instagram, and it's just her holding like countless hand or body of young third world child that wants to learn skateboarding from, in my opinion, one of the greatest human beings I've met. Jenna's amazing. That gets me emotional. She's so fucking dope and super sweet.
Yeah.
And like her whole purpose is just to like be good to other humans, which
also
fuck, we need more of that.
She's always thrived on human connection and
she's a hugger
and meeting people.
She's never not touched us, you know, like she's that person.
Yeah, and affecting people's lives and being involved in their lives and stuff. And we can't lose that. Like here's the thing.
No.
This is a small period of time and we'll get through it. Things will.
And we're in that weird spot now where even saying that we'll get through it, sometimes people like they hear you say that and they think, well, you're not being cautious enough. And it's like, no, we are being cautious.
Yeah.
Right now I do want everybody to be cautious. But like you and I've even talked about this I would like to attempt to go back to, and I don't want to be overly cautious either, because I think being overly cautious at some point
can hinder your life.
Will hinder your life. And we only have one shot at this. Depending on what you believe, science says you got one.
Yeah. Just be,
and I'm just saying.
When I'm at the end, don't let this whole scenario make you a hermit and not have those connections and not have those experiences, because don't let fear rule your life once everything's said. Like I said, not now, but obviously once science says it's safe and every, get back to it. You got to get back to living.
Yeah. Oh, I'm down. Yeah. I'm totally down. Let's do our shot and our toast.
Yeah.
And then we'll ease into the third segment like an old man into a bath.
I like that.
Best thing you've ever said. Hold on, Butler. Let me get. There you are. There's your echo.
All right. Good. Rain, go away. Killing this virus with antiseptic spray. Kind of tastes like vodka. Thank you, Mr. Works. Also, happy birthday to Sam. Send her all the twerks. Hashtag twerks for Sam. 90210.
All right. Twerks for Sam. I like it. Ooh, tequila.
Ooh. Oh, that's good.
Oh, yeah.
I fucking love tequila.
Yeah.
When this is all said and done, whale, I know I'm not in the business department, but my white whale, tequila.
Yeah.
We got to get some tequila.
Butler was spraying vodka all over me and Tom's hands this morning.
That stuff's great.
Yeah, Sugar Works.
Yeah, Sugar Works distillery.
Here, give me some. I'll do a give me a spritz.
It does smell a little like vodka, but it's alcohol and
thank you, sir. Oh, that's good.
It's a good distillery.
Washy washy.
Got it in washy, my washy. Finger cuts.
You know what? I'd rather have that than my wife gave
that
me some
gel stuff.
Yeah, well, some stinky aloe.
Wife gave me one that's got aloe, but it's got these micro beads in it that like have a smell.
Yeah.
I don't want it to smell like, and she tries to overly masculine it for me. So if she goes to Bath and Body Works Like, she gets, oh, she's like, oh, I got cherry blossom for Maisie, and then I got me, I got Freesia and Peach, and then for you, I got gunmetal. And I'm like, I don't want fucking gunmetal.
She gets individual different ones for each person of the household?
She's so fucking organized. You saw the flowers in Animal Crossing.
I got
my husband
bourbon body wash. Smells great.
I like a black pepper body wash from Molton Brown. That's that British company. Yeah, I like stuff like that. But yeah, you don't have to do that. But the sugar works. I like that.
Yeah, yeah. I just need an alcohol.
Yeah, and it's thin. It's easy.
Mm-hmm. Also, it smells like you're a Russian boxer.
Hey, look out, the man, tiny man. Let's take a little bit of a break. And these guys are local. Friends of Tony Rage. I've played them time and time again. They got new music out. Just came out this year. The album's called Citizen of Nothing. The name of the band is 430 Steps. The name of the song?
I know those guys.
Wasting Time. They're so good. If you like thrash, you know, if you're Municipal Waste, Suicidal Tendencies, stuff like that, you'll like these guys. We'll be back. 1-844-TOMNDAN show at TomandDan.com. Last call for emails. Let's jump around a little bit. Well, that's a strange ending for a song. Welcome back to A Mediocre Time with Tom and Dan. I'm Dan.
I'm Samantha, Tom.
Our producer's here. Butler's in the other room talking about Penny Dreadful. It's a good show. Welcome back, guys.
Let's do some voicemail and email.
Yeah. Oh, I forgot about mail on mail.
I will. I'll plug. Trulieve. If you're looking for some THC, they got three dispensaries.
If you're looking for some THC, then you got to ask me about Trulieve.
It'll help.
Leave your cares behind.
Staying home. If you got some THC, I'm just telling you. Plus, you can get your recommendation card. Now, I believe you could even start with telemedicine. Probably.
No, I don't think the initial appointment
one,
you have to be in person. But I'm doing my telemedicine re-up this afternoon after the show.
Oh, really?
It is easy.
When am I going to do mine? I'm about to.
You're the same day as mine, so you better do yours soon.
Wait, does it expire like today or?
No,
like...
mine expires next month. So yours does as well.
Oh, you got a million years.
Yeah, thank you. I got Tony Palmiotti over here. The cruise is 9 years away. We got to order the T-shirts. We need the fucking T-shirts.
Better to do it now.
I'm sorry.
So check out Trulieve.com. Maybe that True Powder is good.
True Wax. Crazy.
I like the True Stick.
Oh, yeah. The True Pods.
Yeah, the True Stick with the True Pods. That's because it's magnetic.
Yeah, I
like the little.
I love it.
It just like clicks in, and then he click in a different one.
Sleek and sexy.
And it's longer. And I got the Sunshine Cannabis one. It's really nice. Yeah, it's gold. Yeah, it's
if you're not into smoking, they got pills and things like
that. True Powder.
That's where you get the crazy red pill.
Don't talk about
it. I'm gonna pop one of those today or Sunday for my birthday.
No.
Do it. You still got those, right? Yeah. All right, mail on mail.
Yep.
Hey guys, thanks for calling 1-800-HOT-DICK, the place to find real action with real men. To make it even better, we've got new low prices. So low, we're practically giving it away free.
If you are a man seeking a woman, press 1. If you are a woman seeking a man, press 2. If you are a man seeking a man, press 3.
Mail a mail brought to you by Mike Kramer Law Firm. Give them a call. They do things online so you don't have to go into the office. So if you have any sort of legal problem that you need some consultation, use MikeKramerLawFirm.com. One firm for life.
First email.
All right. Hey, I listened to the Get Serious episode where Tom talked about trying to fix things again. I am on the other end of the fix-it spectrum. I have built a kitchen addition, including electric, plumbing, flooring, etc., with proper permits and inspections. I do my own car repairs, however, I do leave some of the big jobs to professional mechanic men because I don't have time. Instead of saying, don't touch that, my wife says, go fix that shit. Sometimes I wish I could just hire someone. Trust me, Tom, I don't get more Heroes BJs just because I fix my own stuff. I got to thinking about how I learned these skills over the years. Many of the basics came in eighth grade when we had actual shop classes.
Yeah.
We learned how to do woodworking, welding, and small engine repair. By high school,
it was a better time. we were mean to the brown people.
Oh, no. By high school, I could rebuild an outboard motor, mold, and use plastic ashtrays and stare straight ahead at nothing for 30 minutes. Why have we quit teaching these life skills to our kids? We are so afraid that our little snowflakes will cut off fingers, burn themselves, get cancer, or God forbid, be bored. We gave up trying to teach them real shit.
I don't think it's that.
Were any of these classes available when you went to school? Thoughts?
Yeah, they were shop, you know.
I took shop for like 2 years in middle school. Yeah, I loved it.
Mechanics
class. I made a guitar in shop.
I believe all of that stuff is still readily available. I don't think kids like it because it's old school shit.
You're wrong. So I talked about this on Semantics. Me and my husband got into this show that's on Disney Plus called Shop Class, and it's hosted by Justin Long, and it's all just a bunch of kids in teams building shit. I really like it.
Well, the thing is, you're looking at that like that's what they're doing in school, and they ain't doing that.
Oh, it's not what they're doing in school. They're doing it at home.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm saying the shop class and the things that you know, America's
cool.
doing. Well, you're usually going to deal with some teacher, underpaid teacher that's miserable.
And if you're rolling the dice, he's arguably going to be the dickhead.
That has lost the passion for teaching because years of being in the system has beat the passion out of him. So all he does is show up every year and say, make your goddamn birdhouse. I'll be over here scrolling the internet.
looking at Tinder.
Yeah. Like, you know, so then it becomes less fun, of course, because guess what? We underpaid teachers.
Well, they cut the funding for any kind of class like that.
Well,
anyway.
Shop class was never fun. You had to learn all the basic bullshit before you got to anything cool. Like, I mean, I had to learn all about all the drill press.
Fun.
I loved it. No, I loved the shop class. I mean, but I mean, you have to
do all the learning about all that. And then I'm trying to like revisit it now that I'm starting to quote unquote woodwork at my house. And I'm like, oh yeah, I remember how to do this.
So two things I thought about this. First, I 100% agree with this gentleman. We should be teaching skills like this to kids. Not only that, teaching skills like how to search the internet for legitimate information, right? That we should teach in a class on like
how to vet.
How to vet information, because that seems useful nowadays.
No, you're right. Like Germany's educational system was set up like this for many, many years, where you had like the like almost more the artistic and scientific track, and then you had the vocational and more blue collar track, and neither was like elevated over the other,
right.
You know, it's like you understand what you're good at. I mean, like just because you can fix a car amazing, or just because you can sing amazing, I mean, both are, you know.
In Virginia, there was schools, there was vocational high schools you could opt into going to if you wanted to.
Of course.
I mean, but.
And guess what? How about we take a logical approach and look at our kids and maybe point them in the right direction and be like, all right, does your family, can they afford for a 4-year university or whatever, or do you have the opportunity to get scholarships? If not, maybe this is better suited for you. Guess what? Listen, there's a lot of like if you go and learn like electrician repair, like masonry, carpentry, all the all these jobs that guess what? There are we've seen.
I want to be a court reporter.
There's no. I mean,
top fast.
I actually would like to do that.
When
I hear all the crazy stories.
Yeah, but you use that wacky keyboard that has all the shorthand.
Yeah, and that will be obsolete, by the way.
This button means murder.
That'll be taken over by computers.
When I was in school, graduating from high school, you had the opportunity to Newport News. They had the Newport News Shipbuilding. They had an apprenticeship school.
The
you could
Newport
go
News Shipbuilding?
Shipbuilding. Yeah, it's where they build like nuclear submarines and aircraft carriers. And you could actually go to the apprentice school there. And it's like a 4-year trade school they teach you, but you were guaranteed a job there that paid you pretty damn good.
That's awesome.
I mean, because when I graduated in 2000, everybody was pushing everybody to 4-year universities, and the idea, I remember this, the idea was just go to a university, you'll figure out what you're going to do. Well, guess what? That caused a bunch of fucking, we see it now, a bunch of kids with an insane amount of college debt that ended up getting, and no offense, Daniel, but an interdisciplinary studies degree or a political science degree.
None taken.
Or, to me, a business management degree, which, by the way, I've used nothing in that degree to help me with this at all or this business or anything. I can't even remember what I've learned. Anyway, all this useless education. Now, some of it, like if you want to become an engineer or if you have an idea of like your path, great, go to university. If not, don't just go there and be like, I'll figure it out, because you won't. No one does. Every one of my friends who went there didn't, and I had friends that the wizard got master's degrees because he was convinced, like, oh, if I get a master's degree, I'll definitely get, you know, and now it's kind of working out for him, but he's got, $110,000 worth of debt.
Well, my wife still paying off. That. She's getting her master's now.
Well, she's doing it.
Yeah, but I'm like, why are you doing that? She's like, it's a personal achievement.
Achievement. How many Mick Ultras have you had over there?
And I'm like, it doesn't matter. Personal achievement doesn't matter.
I'm
like, how much money can you make the family?
Here's the thing. This is the one of the problems I see is that going back to bringing these things back to like our education system is that the kids have to be into it. And I can imagine when Tommy and Max get into high school, me saying, you should learn woodworking and mechanics. That'll be I wish I learned that when I was a kid. I'll be like, shut up, old man. Like, you know, like I want the internet. The internet will tell me everything. That's it. And I'll, you know, like, their mentality, you're looking at it.
I just 3D printed some wood.
We're all looking at it as experienced adults that saw the world. And that's what, just like our parents told us shit, they were like, shut up, old man or old woman. Like, you don't know nothing. That's how everybody is. And for so sure. We're looking back.
Oh, yeah. I definitely YouTubed videos this past weekend to figure out how to build this goddamn cat condo.
Yeah, but it was great.
I'm saying I didn't have to take a class for it. Just watched a YouTube video.
No, just step by step. Yeah.
But if you, I do, and I am jealous of the guys, like the Gannons of the world, and this guy that has that base of knowledge that can actually work on their own cars.
But in a lot of ways, it goes back to your old theory of that you would have needed to live in a household where your father or mother had to jump from odd job to odd job in order to gather the amount of knowledge, like blanket you with.
Well, they'll have to know to teach you.
But there's a little bit of dysfunction, I think, that's sprinkled on top of that, right?
Well, I've often thought of this. Like, my dad was a diesel mechanic, and apparently, from what my mom and my pop told me, like, a really good one. Self-taught or whatever. But he died when I was 10. I wonder, like, how much would I have like learn from him or wanted to learn.
Did you like tinker around with him at all, like in the garage?
Yeah, I mean, there are like pictures of like him working on his race car.
But you just don't remember it?
No. And like I'm laying as a baby on his, like he's on one of those rollers underneath the car.
I don't mean as a baby. That's as a kid.
Yeah.
Because you were 10. I mean, you had experiences with him.
I think in those years, it's like who's going to go and work with their dad in a fucking boat? You know, it's like you're 7 years old. What is he going
to
teach you?
I think we need to put you in a deprivation tank and try to draw these memories out.
Yeah, I think
you
blacked a lot of it out.
And then make you freak out and cry.
But you're not going to retain, like, that takes years. Once you become, like, a teenager, an adult, and wanting to learn, like, it would take years for, to build that knowledge. But would I be interested in that when I was a teenager? Probably not. Like, if my dad didn't die and he's like, come and work on the race car, we'd be like, I want to get drunk.
Well, you don't know. Some kids are like that.
Yeah, all right.
You might have been. Just don't know.
But then I look at it like, okay, maybe you were born to
have an interest in it.
Yeah. So then, like, some people do and some people don't. And that's what it takes rather than having a parent that teaches you or teaching you in school. Because there's a lot of people that went to shop class and don't know how to do shit nowadays. And then some people that picked it up and liked it and then had the brain for it. It's just like anything. It's like all of our brains work differently.
The other side of this, just to give some comments from the Twitch chat room, people are underestimating the value of the piece of paper, though. I didn't learn much in college, but wouldn't have gotten the job with knowing what I know. It's almost like you got to go through the club.
That's also a flaw in the system.
I think, my husband's been working for the same company for, like, a goddamn decade, right? And he just got his bachelor's and then immediately got a promotion and a raise.
Nice.
It's like, because you need that piece of paper sometimes for certain things.
Of course, because
even though, like, he's like, I didn't fucking learn anything.
Yeah, well, they're markers, right? That's all it is. It's a marker to his bosses to let them know
that you have
that
discipline.
He's a smart motherfucker.
Yeah, but he had the discipline. He's been with him for a decade. They knew that already.
But it's easier to know it when he can present.
But if he didn't gain any any practical knowledge for the job, what the fuck does it matter?
But he,
I think that's dumb. I totally agree with Sam.
But I understand what you guys are saying. I get it.
It's just a notch on the belt. Like, hey, he sat through the class. He's disciplined enough to do this. He's tasked.
Way to vet.
Yeah. He's a team worker, team builder, and all that.
But Daniel's right. Like, and what it all comes down to is, like, if there's a pool of people looking for a job and one guy's got a degree, at least that tells the guy that's hiring him, well, he went through this. If you look at it, like, he went through this test and he passed it, and it was hard to get. So that tells me that at least if you're looking at, if all everybody's the same and it got the same experience, this guy passed a harder test. Therefore, it puts him a notch above all that.
Bullshit.
Yeah, it is, of course, but it's our system and it's changing and shit. There are tons of. Like I said, there's a shortage
right now.
There's a shortage in a lot of this work that you're seeing now, where it's hard to find a really good carpenter, electrician, plumber, and the really good ones are insanely busy.
It was easy to find one when OxyContin was more readily available. It was. You know, when the pain management clinics were open, you know how easy it was to find somebody to trim my trees or do something for me?
They need money. They need money for that sweet, sweet poison.
Yeah, but now that you dried that up, then most of them probably like went through withdrawal and died. So I hope you're happy, Florida.
I was only working this hard to get my poison.
Yeah, exactly. And like, you shut the poison down so all these people died.
Yeah, like, I don't want to work really hard just to go home and drink a couple Miller Lights.
Yeah, Miller Lights boring. Let's try. Oh no, this is gonna make you mad. It's Manny Manny. No.
Tom, Dan, Sam, Butler.
Yes.
I think Tom's gonna agree with me on this. I think he has the same opinion about garbage as I do. I know it's not okay. You know, you look at the positives of the coronavirus because I know some people are struggling. But I live in a community where you gotta buy your trash bags for $1 a piece. And they'll only pick up those trash bags. You know, it's just cut down on, you know, try to help you recycle more. And it does work. But man, isn't it good to be able to just take one of those big old black trash bags and just stuff it full of garbage and just throw it away? What do you guys think? What's your take on the positives? Anyway, love the show, guys. Hang in there. Later.
I don't get it.
I don't know what he's talking about.
And he's extra wet on that one.
He's out of breath.
What is he talking about?
He's living in a gated community or something like that where they actually sell you the plastic bags for your trash and you have to use
specific
bags in order to get the pickup. They won't take any other generic bag. You have to get your trash picked up by this trash bag.
What?
Well,
really?
Like in my neighborhood, they won't pick up your trash unless you use the...
It sounds like a mobile home facility.
The city cans, because the first mistake I made when I moved here...
That's normal.
Was to put up regular, like I had regular cans I bought.
I bought them
because I didn't know shit for shit. I bought them, put them out there, and then they put a note on there, we will not take these.
Yeah, because they needed to pick them up.
So I just threw them away.
Well, that's different than
throwing
a particular
away a trash can's hard, by the way.
Trash bag. I know.
You got to cut it up.
Yeah, yeah. Or you got to put a note on it.
Yeah, I cut it up.
Or if you stick it inside the other trash can, it's confusing, but eventually they'll get it.
Yeah, it'll just fall out and they won't care.
But so he's saying that you have to use a particular trash bag. Wait, is it something different than the ones you could buy at anywhere?
Well, even here, like I'm using Bobo trash bags in our front.
Yeah, it's
like,
falling through and his fajitas are falling out the bottom.
Yeah, your fajitas fell out the bottom.
Well, that's only because the receptacle is
Why do you even buy that? That's an expensive meal and you ate like one bite of chicken.
Yeah, you only eat like a quarter of it and it's like $9.
Do you have AIDS? Because like you're getting too skinny, man.
Listen, I've still got...
Your dad dukes are falling off.
I could lose another 10.
Yeah. No, you can't. I don't think you can.
I think he's got the AIDS.
So, anyway.
Jenna likes her men thick.
You made him uncomfortable. He's like, don't go to my house.
I don't understand, Manny. Does anybody understand?
I do not.
No. Maybe he was too wet and he was delirious. next email.
Oh, let's see.
I got another one.
I got a lot
here,
of long
I'll
ones
go,
over
I'll
here.
Go with this one because it's a two-parter.
Okay.
Tom, Ben. So I can't get my mediocre message to work. By the way, the little call thing before the Tom and Dan number, pretty awesome. Good job, guys. So this is Joe, the Taco Man. I posted how I do my tacos on the BDM page, and Dan was interested. I was going to call in, but I just woke up after my night shift and was like, they don't want to hear about my stinky ass tacos. But I figured I'd call and leave a voicemail. I'm on a drive to Lake City to go to a wedding right now, and didn't really have a whole lot better to do, so I figured I'd call you guys. So if you do air this, that'd be awesome. But Dan, this one's really for you and anybody else that wants to hear. But
get to the goddamn talk
about this. So I make my ground beef, season it, all my stuff. Then I add the refried beans, which I said no, you guys are like back and forth on. But the refried beans add a little bit of a, you know, they more substance to the meat and they can spread a little further. Then you take and you do about a, you know, tablespoon worth of like meat and beans into the hard taco shells, unbaked. The unbaked taco shells, sprinkle a little shredded cheese on top, bake them how you're supposed to bake them. You know, you can kind of like lean them up against each other on a cookie sheet and do them. And then you bake them for the allotted time, pull them out, add your cold toppings. That way nobody picks too.
Okay.
Don't forget your cheese, and then you put the hot sauce. Make sure you shake the hot sauce.
The reason I played this one, too, is to also kind of segue into that I finally found the deal that I wanted on one of those flat-top grills.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah.
It came in yesterday. They're real popular in the BDM like cooking group.
Ah.
You know, there's a bunch of guys that got these, you know, Blackstone
griddles.
Yeah, but it's like a big griddle where you can do like a full breakfast or a dinner or stuff like that. And finally, I've been waiting years. I mean fucking years. And I found a really good deal on one. If you want it, I'll try to track it down for you. But it got delivered. I got to put it together. I got to season the griddle. It's going to be super fun. But what should I cook on it first?
Cheese stick.
I want to do a cheese stick.
I thought you were going to do like a Kobe scenario.
I
want to
do a Kobe.
Yeah.
It's probably going to end up being breakfast. Now, there's rules to this. See, this is the kind of shit that would drive Tom crazy.
Bacon.
I understand.
Hash browns.
What they say. See, he knows. Travis knows.
What?
Well,
the rule is the first thing that you cook on an unseasoned griddle top should be bacon or high fat content because
what
you want to season
like bacon?
It.
Sausage? Yeah.
Get the fuck out.
You gotta. Bye. Because I'm supposedly.
You don't like bacon?
I have to go home after the show, put it together, which is going to be. I mean, the thing is, it's the heaviest fucking thing I own. Put it together. Then I'm supposed to wipe like canola oil on it and bake this thing at high heat. Because you gotta bake it, you gotta season that cooktop just like you would a cast iron skillet. This is why you don't like cooking, because there's...
I can't do it right.
I know, you want to rush right in. Yeah. Look, I'm
I'll
with
open
you
the
because
box,
I
turn it on.
Like,
throw the
and I knew this would be something we could talk about, because you know that I'm not gonna not season my cooktop correctly, because why the fuck would I buy something and then... do it wrong.
Yeah.
You know, I need to protect the investment. I need to wipe that oil correctly, get the temperature correct.
This kind of ties into my pubes. And I'll tell you.
You're griddling your pubes?
Don't griddle your pubes, man. That's the worst way to cut them, I heard.
If you're going
to
do it in canola.
Yeah, you got to get the canola.
I've been using the same trimmer for I'm not even exaggerating. Since high school, literally.
No.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
So did you even have pubes back then?
Barely.
What were you using it on?
But it's a tiny.
Well, you got butt hairs first, I bet.
It's about 5 inches. It's silver. It's small. It's probably like the actual clipper part of it is only about an inch and a half wide.
Dull, too.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. And you must be nicking your balls all the time.
It takes. Oh, yeah. This
old
thing.
Old scabby balls over here.
This thing will chomp.
They're tiny scabs.
It is.
If you get in the shower early and rinse it, yeah, it stings. You get to oil it, and that'll stop the bleeding.
This thing's for $99, by the way. Speaking of oil,
ridiculous.
I've never oiled it, never done anything to it.
$99 is like Warren G.
I've replaced it.
What brand is this?
I don't even know.
Prince was still partying.
It doesn't even have a brand on the. I'll show you the picture.
Yeah,
like, dead
please
serious.
Do.
It takes one.
It's Halliburton, I think.
One AA battery that fits in there. By the way,
the
it's all
hell?
Rusted inside. Anyway,
it's
so
not rusted. That's called corrosion.
I'm goddamn 30. This thing is 20, more than 20 years old.
Oh, my God.
So the other day, I pulled it out, old silver rusty. And
what, you call it that? You're like, let me put a battery in you, old silver. You're all right,
and by the
girl,
way, it'll
be
like a double barrel shotgun. It's like the double A.
It'll cut you crazy. It's dangerous.
Well, yeah,
like, insanely
it's 20
dangerous.
Years old.
I thought to myself, I was like, you know what?
They're saying it's a seasoned pair of clippers.
Oh, yeah.
I said, I'm going to buy new groomer because I hear these like ads on podcasts.
Treat yourself. And,
you know,
I gotta buzz down some of this hair so I got less friction when I'm really in there ram jamming the crow. I gotta buzz down some of my friction crows.
So
can you feel the hairs going in and out like a pipe cleaner, crow?
I took my phone and I was like, you know what? I'm just going to go to Amazon. And I'm like, I've heard Manscaped on podcasts. I'm going to buy that. I'm like, buy or whatever. And
or whatever.
And then a couple days later, I finally figured out how to use my Amazon the
Holy
past month.
Holy shit, there's a box with a Manscaper in it in my mailbox. Who put this here?
I buy shit every day. Well, my wife never hooked up my account where I had to buy it now one click.
Because she's smart. Yeah.
But I finally, I had time.
Yeah, I had to get my own too because Andrea did that. She's like, I don't want you doing one click. I know what you do.
So
that's how I bought the Blackstone.
Yeah.
I found a deal. I was like, one click, boom.
So it shows up. And
what do you mean it won't be here tomorrow? $63 shipping.
And I it showed up. I'm like, oh, there it is. I ran to the bathroom. I take off the packaging, take it out, and then I immediately I'm going to shave my pubes right now.
And where were you, in the living room?
Nothing can stop me. I know I'm in the middle of eating this Gringo's burrito with my family. Guys, keep my mouth hugger warm. I got to trim my pubes.
Then I turn it on, and then I start, and it just individually pulls out.
No!
I'm like, yeah! Pulled out every.
You got a tweezer?
I'm like, it's like having a midget a with tweezers. Pull out every hair on your
body. And I'm like, yeah! And it hurt like a motherfucker.
It's like having Wee Man.
It was so
it's like having Wee Man from Jackass with tweezers. Just yanking him crazy.
And I'm like, yeah! And then, I was like, this why does it hurt so much?
This is called midget with tweezers.
And then. You know,
you gotta charge it.
Then I look at this as like, you do not operate without charging for a full 5 hours.
Oh, you did it slow. You did it slow. So they're,
slow and
they're
dry.
Pulling them slow. You ever pull the nose hair slow?
Yeah.
I'm so sadistic that sometimes I'll see a nose hair and I'll put the tweezers on it. And it's gray, and I pinch it and I go, I got it, and I'll pull it until it's taut, and I'll go. Stare into your own eyes, you piece of shit. And I'll stare into my own eyes and I'll go, you're a piece of shit. And I'll just pull it. Right, you deserve this. You deserve every fucking minute.
Your
of
eyes
this,
are
you
watering.
Piece of shit. No, not yet. But it's stretching the membrane of my nose. I was like, yeah. And then he goes, yeah. And I'm like, punk.
Yeah. So that's what I was doing to my pubes.
Oh my god!
Did you get a rash or anything?
No, of course,
he has a rash. He always has a rash. If you love this show, you know that.
It's full rash.
How often do you manscape?
We have been begging you to look at our rashes for years.
Anyway, And then I charged it for 5 hours, and it still pulled me a little bit. I was like, nah, it's honky shit.
The Panasonic. That's
I got the Norelka. You got a Panasonic?
My buddy.
Back to old Rusty.
No, I got the
tried and true. Before they had like a safety feature.
Mine gets too close. Like mine, it's like okay, like I'm buzzing. You got to get the crannies.
The nooks and crannies.
If it's not
hashtag Animal Crossing, you got to do the nooks and crannies in there. So, but mine's got that blade that an old construction worker would use. Remember the tube? It's got the foil.
Yeah.
With the holes, and your hair goes in the holes on the foil, and it cuts it. Yeah. And mine's got that. So I can get in the nooks and crannies, and it'll go.
I
mean,
I don't go skin.
I go in, I'm like,
if it's not powerful enough to actually mutilate your balls, I don't want it.
Because
that tells me it's got the power for the pubes.
You know, I was here. Yeah, I'm gonna tell a story. It's a little too far, but I'm gonna tell it. And we're coming up on the end of the show. I laid a doo doo in the toilet yesterday that was unflushable, and it.
I saw it. Yeah.
And
we all saw it.
Yeah, it
none
just,
of us could flush
it. Just wouldn't go away. It was unflushable. It was very sticky. So
very sticky. Yeah.
It was a sticky doo doo. I was wiping that doo-doo, and I saw a hair on the toilet paper. Because unlike Ross, and we've talked about this before, when I wipe, I always look at the paper. Ross says he doesn't. I don't know if he still does. Maybe he changed. But I saw a hair on there, and I was like, you know what? I got to get rid of my butt hair.
That's a bad
idea. Nair? Use Nair.
I was gonna do like my wife does. I mean, like, girls are consistently... having to trim their butt hair? And do they have less butt hair because of a lack of testosterone?
Yeah. Yeah, probably, I think so. Yeah. It's not like
that. It's got to be spiky when it's growing in.
Well, I'm going to have to like maintain it.
Yeah, see, it's like either you start it and you can't finish.
Yeah. Have you looked back there to see how much you have? Like mirrored it?
Yeah, it's like Fidel Castro. Yeah.
No, mine, no, it's not a lot. I'm not,
Balloon, not lips.
My dog's like, we gotta cut her butt hair.
No, I'm not super, like, I'm not a super hairy guy, but, like, I just kind of felt like I want to get rid of the hair back there because it's just something to get clumped up with doo-doo.
So collects just the doo-doos and the dingleberries.
My logic,
it burns your butthole, though, right?
Nah.
I can't use Nair. I think I'm allergic to it.
Yeah, some people are sensitive to the chemicals.
Just get a bidet and kind of blast the doo-doo out of your hair.
No, blast the doo-doo out of your hair.
I don't want any hair back there, though.
Yeah.
I don't think I need it.
But it's been there forever, right?
Nair it off. It's the cleanest way to go. Because if you try trimmer, you have to, like, squat over a mirror.
Do I pack the...
Pack it in, bro.
Do I pack the Nair into my butt like a old sailor would pack tobacco into a pipe?
Mm. Not in the butt.
Tom, you know a lot about this Nair. You Nair your asshole, don't you?
I've done it one time. My wife
has kink.
What do you do? Do you wipe it on, then wipe out your hair?
No, his kink
is... Or does it just like chemically dissolve your hair?
I'm telling you right now, his kink is to be like fully shaved and be smooth. And I guarantee you that this guy is a baby oil. Look, he's turning red.
Now, see, one time you said you, quote, accidentally shaved your armpits. Are they still shaved?
No, they grew back.
I was wondering if you kept up with
it.
But
he grew back an extra armpit.
Why don't you Nair your armpit?
Yeah.
No. Oh, yeah, I should have, because shaving them caused a lot of problems.
Why don't you shave your armpits and then take the hair from your armpit and stick it in your butthole?
Mm-hmm. thanks for listening today. Nothing good will happen after this, so we're going to call it. let's see. Johnny's is running a promotion right now. If you order from Johnny's, anything over $15 will come with a free craft beer of your choice. And every $15, you get a free craft beer. So if you order for your family and it's $30, request some beers for yourself.
Yeah.
And they got a
big catfish po' boy right now.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
That looks legit.
And they got some good craft beers, too. So
fish sandwich is where it's at.
Yeah.
Tuffy's also got a... Relief shirt going on as well. I don't know if you're about to mention that.
Let's talk about that.
If you buy a shirt from Tuffy's, I believe all of the proceeds go to the staff.
Go to the staff, absolutely.
Yeah, I know Tuffy's is running promotions, West End, Celery City. By the way, look at all their Facebook pages. They all are promoting them. But on TomandDan.com, the top banner, there's help out small businesses, all of our sponsors and partners, and there's a list of how you could help out.
You know what?
Thanks, Mike B.
In 2009, an almost little person and an almost special needs person started a podcast because they hated their day jobs. These men promptly resigned from their positions and escaped to the Orlando Underground. Today, still hated by people who think radio is relevant, they survive as podcasters of fortune. If you have a problem, they won't be any help. But if you can find them, maybe you can hire the RT.
So
Tom was right. Nothing good could have come after that. And
so Remy,
I saw Daniel see it, and they're like, "Oh, I'm gonna play that."
Remy reached out to us, and he wanted us to be on his podcast yesterday during the exact time that we record the actual radio show that pays the bills for the fucking studio. But we will be on Goof Talk, right?
Yeah. Well, what's that, the planet out with it?
Here's Butler's favorite part. Do you hear Butler?
No, that's it.
I don't know this book.
I don't know this.
Like, Butler loves that book.
All right. Thank you guys for listening to the show and for supporting us and being BDMs.
Yeah,
and
support all our sponsors. It really does mean more than you know, the fact that you guys do that. You know, we've been hearing from our sponsors about a lot of you guys, like, checking in because, you know, obviously we have a lot more time on our hands, so that's a good thing. But, yeah, I don't think there's anything else, right?
No. Samantha, happy birthday.
Thank you.
Happy birthday.
Yeah.
What do you want? Because I'll buy something over the
buy
weekend.
Buy her a drone.
When's your actual birthday?
Sunday. It's on
okay.
Sunday.
If we buy you a drone, Monday. Will you fly it over your own self, like in a bikini, and then send us the video?
If you can, right now, I mean, I don't want to put you on the spot.
We talk about, like, yesterday or the day before, and I was like, I want you to do that. Was it something with your hair?
Yeah.
No, I don't know. What do you want for real?
You wanted us to whip our hair back and forth. And
no.
What does Samantha Haar want for
you? Probably
birthday?
Want a massage from me and Tom, right?
Why'd you say that?
I'll sit in the corner.
No. Cuckold massage?
One day, your special will be funny again. Can't say it now. What would you want? If you had your choice, anything under...
Other than a massage from me and Tom.
Keep the budget under 100.
Under 100.
Above 50.
Above 50. Yeah.
Well, above, that's at the price range.
Above 25.
I don't know. I don't really want anything.
Nothing?
Nothing?
Not really.
How about some cookware, a piece of furniture for the new place?
Yeah.
Piece of podcasting equipment?
Some weed.
Yeah. Some weed, a massage. What are you...
If you leave it up to
my
me,
my husband's giving me a massage for my birthday.
I slipped it in again.
I don't trust anybody else.
I want to go back. I want to get you something absolutely ridiculous.
I'm
going
to get you lingerie.
I want to get you.
I love uncomfortable gifts that you should
unwrap
not
it and
be
you're like,
that.
Okay.
And you're like, wow. And I'm like, hey, I got you crotchless. I know.
This isn't
going
to fit. I got you a dildo.
Hey, I got you crotchless. And, I don't want to, you know, I'm not tooting my own horn, but that second box over there, let's just say it's got a butt plug with a tail on it, squirrel tail.
I've always wanted to get ridiculous, like, things that I know the person's not into, but it's awesome nonetheless, like a mini street bike.
You
know?
Yeah.
Okay, like, I'll take a go-kart, but it's not going to be under $100, probably.
No, we can get one.
I got one for $50.
Yeah.
I don't know if my new HOA is going to appreciate me riding around the neighborhood.
You'll have it in your garage, and eventually
plead ignorance, you're fine.
The carburetor will clog up and you put regular non-ethanol gas in there, and then it will never start
again.
Get
her a one-wheel.
I don't want that.
What? All right.
That
I've hear, tried riding it before does. And I almost died.
We didn't do it well enough. It takes some finesse.
Yeah, it's easier to ride with
Tom's
your shirt
Tom's just trying
on.
To hold me the whole time on the one wheel. That inappropriate. Tom,
I said hold my shoulders.
I wasn't even falling off and he grabbed me like I was falling
come
off.
Come on.
The easiest way to tell somebody he to ride a one wheel is to hold their nipples and pull them forward.
You know what?
Oh, whoa, you're about to fall, hold on, I gotta get a good grip around there.
That's what he did.
Yeah, I know. I know how he is. It's like the time he tried to teach me to walk a balance beam.
I teach.
By the end of the balance beam, he's just jacking me off. I'm like, this is weird.
You don't know my methods. All right.
Hit like a Russian skating coach.
Happy birthday, Sam.
Thanks.
So, guys, we'll see you next week.
Oh, I know what I want for my birthday. I want Tom Van to send my podcast an email for tonight.
Oh!
I was supposed to leave a voicemail for Ross's podcast.
You didn't do that?
No.
Oh, he's going to hate you real bad.
You know what? You're wired to be an asshole.
Now he really hates you.
I don't know. I just forget. Every day
put
I'm like,
your
I'm,
phone.
I know.
Set an alarm.
But then I'm like, what story should I tell? Then I get distracted.
There's
then I'm
nothing
like,
that pisses off wired to be an asshole more than wired to be wired to be forgetful. And then wired to be an asshole is like, what he said. I planned my show.
Our personalities are oil and water.
And then the second thing that wired to be an asshole hates is wired to give excuses. And then he really is that.
I know. I'm literally wired to be an asshole's
mortal enemy. It's your natural predator.
I'm wired to be forgetful excuses, man. I'm fucking Mr. Glass and Unbreakable.
Fuck. I needed a good laugh today. All right, y'all. Twitch, we're out. We'll see you later.